It's V-Week on ESPN as we continue Jim Valvano's fight against cancer.
Here in snowy Moscow, Idaho, it's a night 30 years in the making. The Idaho Vandals host their first FCS playoff game since 1993. And you better believe they are cranked up here at the iconic Kibbie Dome. And we welcome you to the P1 FCU Kibbie Dome for the final second round game of the day in the FCS playoffs. Idaho, the number 4 seed, matching up with the Southern Illinois Salukis. It has been mostly chalk so far today in the second round. Defending champion South Dakota State, the top seed, rolled past Mercer. The winner of this one will face the 5 seed, the Albany Great Danes, in the quarterfinals. And hi there and welcome inside the Kibbie Dome, along with the former Penn State great and 12-year NFL veteran, Tyoka Jackson. I'm Ted Emmerich. This is the way to cap Championship Saturday in college football, right? FCS After Dark from Moscow. Don't fall asleep on me.
Come on, man. Let's play.
So we are blessed with a dynamic matchup between two teams from the two best conferences in the FCS, Southern Illinois from the Missouri Valley, Idaho from the Big Sky. We've also got a stellar matchup in the secondary that you have your eye on.
Yeah, let's not bury the lead. We've got a couple stars, two of the best football players playing FCS football at their positions, and it starts with P.J. Jules. His superpower is his versatility. SIU will move him around. He is their leading tackler, their leading pass breakup guy. He gets fumbles out, he does it all. And Hayden Hatton, his superpower is his length, strong but soft hands. Look for them to get this guy to football in the red zone. I can't wait to watch them match up because it's a prime time matchup today.
Idaho won the coin toss and the Vandals want the football. Southern Illinois kicks away, and here is Jermaine Jackson. He is an explosive return man, and he takes it up to the 30-yard line for Idaho. Led by Giovanni McCoy at quarterback, the sophomore from Baldwin Hills, California, south of Los Angeles. His numbers are a little bit down from last year, Ty, when he was the freshman of the year in the FCS, but he's one of the best quarterbacks at this level.
Well, listen, he's still developing. He's a young player who's getting better and better in terms of learning how to play the position. He's a terrific athlete. He can run the football, and that's a big part of what they do offensively.
It's McCoy's first game in 3 weeks. He sat out Idaho's regular season finale with a sprained right ankle. Give it to Anthony Woods on first down. Not much room as Ubaid Steed closes the door for Southern Illinois. Woods close to 1,000 yards on the season.
Yeah, Steve stepped up and made a nice tackle in the hole. They call him Cap, Ubaid Steed, but he's a terrific player. Look again for them to run a lot of running the football, RPOs. They possess the football as well as anybody in the country. And again, the quarterback has the ability to run himself.
When's the last time you saw an offense huddle in college football?
Old school.
Idaho does it.
Old school football. I love it, man.
Fake it to Woods this time. McCoy to throw for the first time tonight. A deep ball, and it's incomplete. He wanted the speedster Jackson.
So these opportunities aren't going to just come and grow on trees, and you can hit them whenever you want. You got to take advantage of this. You see the play action out of the pistol, and you've got a wide-open receiver down the seam, and he just overthrows him. And that's the sort of hit that McCoy has to make because, again, you don't get those wide-open opportunities, and these are two teams that start fast historically, Ted.
So an early third and long for Idaho. The Vandals convert 45% of the time. That's 13th in the nation. But usually they're in third and short. Such an efficient offense. This is uncharacteristic. McCoy setting up the screen for Jordan Dwyer coming off a career game, and Dwyer sniffed out. So Idaho goes 3 and out to start here at home, their first home playoff game in 30 years.
Well, that's outstanding defense. And you can tell right now there's some film study going on because he knew exactly what was coming. That's a terrific job of beating the block and making a tackle all by himself. That's Jameer Khan, true freshman, making a big play in a big game.
Ricardo Chavez, the senior, kicks and punts for Idaho. He punts with his left foot. He kicks extra points and field goals with his right foot. Booms it with the left. Jalen Reed stays away from it, and it takes an Idaho roll inside the 15. A 56-yard punt for Chavez. And so now Nick Baker takes the stage, the sixth-year senior quarterback for Southern Illinois. So he's 5'9", really 5'8", according to the coaching staff. He is the all-time leading passer at the only school to offer him a scholarship.
And they're going to put an asterisk beside those numbers. Those records that he set up, it doesn't matter how tall he is. He just goes out and plays. The guy is a winner. He lost one game in high school, 27-1, two state titles. He brought that type of moxie to this level of football.
Roe Elliott trying to plow up the middle, and Elliott, somehow smaller than Baker, still moving.
No whistles blown. Still no whistle.
Ball comes out at the end. Forward progress stopped at the 20, and it's a gain of 5. Well, this is the matchup when Southern Illinois has the ball. They have sputtered at times. They're facing what's pretty much an elite unit for Idaho defensively.
Yeah, there's no question about it, and you're going to have to pay off this early third down from your defense, and here you go right here.
The tight end, Aiden Quinn, getting involved. Had just 2 catches his first 2 years, and he's got 25 this year. He's become a weapon for the Salukis.
So this time they go out of the shotgun, Ted, and just run a simple out route, but the defender slipped. And that's the type of option you get when you run your tight end to the flat. If he's going to be uncovered, he's going to make plays.
First down at the 35. Quick hitter. And Roe Elliott again, this time the running back catching the pass for a short gain on the play.
So early opportunity for complimentary football. We saw the Saliki defense go out, get off the field on 3 straight downs. That's big, getting these Vandals off the field. Now your offense has to go on a nice, long, clock-eating drive, racking up first downs. This is how you start a big on-the-road upset.
We saw Nick Hill, the head coach, former quarterback himself at Southern Illinois. Nick Baker, his current quarterback, keeping to the 40-yard line. Gain of a couple. And it's 3rd and 5 for the Salukis. Keyshawn James Newby made the tackle, the transfer from NAIA Montana Tech.
What an effort, too. I mean, he was slow to see the developing play, but watch him fall off the table and lean and make a play. That's the type of defense they have. They play hard, Ted. When you watch them on tape, those gold helmets, you get more than once the ball mostly every single play.
Akil told us the difference for his offense this year is when they're humming on third down. They need 5 here. Blitz up the middle. Baker eludes. And the pass is caught by Quinn for the first down. What a play by Nick Baker to keep the play alive.
You think they care that he's 5'8"? This guy's a winner. So here comes the pressure. Beat the pressure. Keep your poise. Look downfield and throw an accurate ball and run. I don't care if you're 6'8 or 5'8, that's winning quarterback football.
Baker making his 40th career start. Oh, fumble on the jet sweep, and Baker falls on top of it right near the line of scrimmage.
So often in these big games, are lost more than won. And there is a huge opportunity right there for the Idaho defense. Just couldn't get it done. And that's something that Southern Illinois does really well. They keep the football. They're +8 in turnover margin. That's 15th in the country. Idaho is -5 in the turnover margin. So that's going to be a huge key to this football game going forward.
And you wouldn't expect that from a top 4 national seed to be negative in the turnover margin. But Idaho is. 2nd and 11. Baker.
Look out.
Running out of time. And he tosses it away.
So again, here's the poise. Looking downfield, feels the pressure, not looking at the rush. Now it's just a foot race. And he's understanding that if I get out of the pocket and throw the football to the line of scrimmage, I don't have to worry about grounding. So that's intelligent football right there by Nick Baker.
Xavier Slayton, the redshirt freshman defensive end from Chicago, is giving chase there.
His brother Chris plays in the NFL for the San Francisco 49ers. So he's got some bloodlines there.
Salukis converted on third down a moment ago. Can they do it here? Underneath, pass is caught, but well short of the first down. Justin Strong makes the grab. Trey Thomas on the tackle, gain of 5, and it's 4th down.
Well, this is excellent third down defense. Take away all the deep routes. And what you do is you leave in Baker nothing but the shallow cross. You let him hit that all day because you're going to come up and rally up and make the tackle fourth down.
Now, so in plus territory, Southern Illinois is pretty aggressive on fourth down, but the decision is to punt it here. Nathan Torning, the Aussie, out to kick it. Jackson, the return man. And they save it just in time, yes! Well done! Inside the five, marked at the one.
Immediate timeout.
The Vandals are 99 yards from the end zone. Pair of punts to start in the FCS second round. The grainy footage, December 4th, 1993, the last home playoff game for the Idaho Vandals. This was in the FCS quarterfinals, then known as Division I AA, facing the Boston Terriers, which discontinued football a few years later. Idaho went on to the semis.
Was that VHS or was that beta? I mean, my goodness.
Man, what an environment here tonight, 30 years later. And of course, Idaho spent 22 years in the FBS. A nice little run. Idaho starting from their own 1 yard line. Fortunate to get out of the end zone there as Anthony Woods just stretches across. But they've been so charged up, Ty, all week. Fans have even donated tickets to students because usually students get in for free.
And listen, let's be honest. I mean, we got a dome here. So you don't got to worry about the elements outside, and the elements are raging. But in here, it's utopia. It's beautiful, and the fans have shown up.
Boy, this is dangerous, right? Taking the snap from your own end zone. Woods again. And a lot of breathing room for Idaho and a first down two. Out to the 14.
So you talked about how dangerous this is because there's going to be a hat in each gap defensively. But if one guy misses a tackle in a situation like this, it could be a house call and they got lucky. Because Woods can find it with the best of them. He averages 107 all-purpose yards. He can do it catching the football, and he's a dynamic runner as well.
And Ty, with that carry, Woods just eclipsed 1,000 yards for the season.
Terrific player.
Woods to the edge this time. And knocked down after a gain of three by middle linebacker Colin Bohannock. Yeah, this is one of the most distinctive venues in college football. Opened as an outdoor stadium in 1971. They added the roof 4 years later.
Well, 1971, the year I was born. So
how about that?
Yeah, the birth of the building, the birth of Tioka.
There's symmetry here. There's a reason you're here tonight.
Only one of those two things are well built. I'm just going to say that right now.
Hey, that's authentic Idaho wood up there.
Absolutely.
Second and seven for Giovanni McCoy. Gets it away. Jake Cox, the tight end, with the grab. And knocked out just short of the line to gain by Zach Barola. Gain of six.
So that's the sort of efficiency you want on second down to set up a third and short. Just hit the guy in the flat. I mean, that's a very simple play, hitting your fullback tight end guy in the flat. And now you're third and one, Teddy. And you've got a lot more options at third and one than you would have at, say, third and seven. You can run the football here. Obviously, the quarterback run game with McCoy is there for you as well.
Yeah, Idaho couldn't convert when it was third and nine on the opening possession.
Full house backfield.
McCoy motions out. Nick Romano takes the Wildcat snap, and Romano, the fifth-year senior running back, moves the chains.
This is what Idaho does. They're number two in the nation at possessing the football in terms of the clock. They will bleed the block with the best of them. And getting these short third down opportunities is how they do it. So it's really about first and second down efficiency that sets up third and manageable for this team.
It's funny because the Idaho coach has told us, Ty, it's not like we're trying to win the clock battle. We want explosive plays, but this year teams are making us drive it, and we're happy to do it. Dink and dunk and march down the field. Underneath the screen, Jermaine Jackson. Boy, is he quick.
Yeah.
Jackson close to the first down marker. Barola the tackle, it's a gain of eight.
Well, he's their quickest player on offense. They get him the football in a variety of ways, and that was just a tunnel screen, well blocked. And Jackson, you can see the quickness in live body.
Jason Eck, the head coach for Idaho, former offensive coordinator at South Dakota State, and he has built an efficient offense here this year in his second season.
Once again, that first down efficiency, though, Ted, it sets up second and short. Don't be shocked if you see a hard play action and go for that big chunk yard as you talked about earlier.
And no throws to Hayden Hatton yet. He's at the bottom of your picture. One of the top receivers in the FCS. And right on cue, McCoy connects with Hatton at the 40-yard line. It's a first down.
Well, the amount of cushion that they gave Hatton was insane. And so a stop route is going to be there all day for number 80. And he didn't like that he got hit after he fell down. Remember, in college football, it plays over when you fall down. You can't hit him. But this is just a straight hitch. But look at the cushion, and that's not even the guy who was guarding him. I mean, that's Jules coming from the inside out. He was over the slot. The corner was so far back. He can hit that all day. It's like stealing.
Hatton and McCoy, receiver and quarterback for Idaho, finalists for the Walter Payton Award, which goes to the FCS Offensive Player of the Year. McCoy retreating. And the pass is incomplete. Defended well by P.J. Jules. Jermaine Jackson was the man McCoy was trying to locate.
Well, they wanted a flag. The hometown crowd wants a flag, but they're not going to get it. This ball wasn't catchable. You see the cross right here. And there's Jules trying to make a play on a ball that's not there. But if it's not catchable, you keep that flag in your pocket.
Yeah, the Idaho fans are saying, oh, Jules is tackling Jackson, but there's no way Jackson was going to catch that anyway.
Yeah.
By the way, Jules, finalist for Defensive Player of the Year in the FCS, the Buck Buchanan Award. Empty set on second and 10.
Ball should come out pretty quickly.
McCoy has a little time against a three-man rush. And McCoy is dragged down by Bohannock in his first year with Southern Illinois, transfer from Eastern Illinois.
That's an outstanding play by Bohannock. And we talked about that ball should come out quickly, but the coverage was terrific. And so now he has to pull him. That's a very good athletic running quarterback that Bohannock ran down. Terrific angle. It's all about the angles, Ted. You don't necessarily have to be the fastest guy on the field. If you take the proper angles, you get to the football. And if you wrap him up, he'll go down. Nice job by Colin. So interesting if they get a pass rush from this three-man line. Will they add a fourth or fifth rusher?
They bring four. McCoy on the quarterback draw. He's got the first down for Idaho. Out across midfield. Gain of 10.
You got to love the call. So take a look at the light box. There's a lot of green in the middle of that field, and he's got a lead blocker. That's just a great call. Quarterback draw all the way. You got to feel that Jason Eck might have had his fingerprints on that call. Really smart.
That's a good sign for McCoy. He told us he wasn't just dealing with the sprained right ankle. He had fluid drain from his leg since the last game he played. The bye really helped him heal and get to 100%. Here's Romano lowering the shoulder out across the 45.
And back to that point, though, this time of year, Ted, everybody's got something. Everybody's a little nicked up. Everybody's a little sore. But fluid draining from the knee, that's something else.
Yeah.
And as you said, he looked really good, and he's not running tentative, which you want to see from a guy who has been nicked up and is in a little bit of pain.
And McCoy has practiced in full for the Vandals since last Saturday, so a full go.
6 yards on first down. I want all the fans that are watching that you keep paying attention to how many yards are coming up on first down for these Vandals, because that sets up really easy third down conversions later on.
Jackson is the motion man. McCoy backpedaling, and he throws it away. Flag down. So a flag there near the line of scrimmage.
That's the area for holding. McCoy's got to be careful with backing up the way he's doing it. There's the holding signal. You notice
holding, offense. 10-yard penalty, second down.
Well, right now, and you're getting the boos because he didn't give us a number. I mean, if you're going to call it, ref, you got to give us a number. And I think right there was number 75. Yeah. Aiden Kaepernick, it was you, Aiden. Look, I understand as an offensive tackle, you don't want the number given, but unfortunately, we saw beautiful camera work. But again, I want to go back to McCoy. The way he's retreating, Teddy, I don't like the way he's getting so much depth instead of getting out of the pocket so he can go ahead and throw it away. He's staying within the pocket and getting depth. That could probably be a disaster later on. Let's keep an eye on how he's getting out of this pressure.
Kind of playing into the hands of one of the best defenses in the FCS when you do that. Romano, short gain here, and it's third and long. Yet again, I mean, this is a Southern Illinois defense, Ty, that ranks top 10 in scoring defense, total defense, rush defense, turnovers forced, and sacks.
And just think of this. They haven't allowed a touchdown in eight quarters. So they not only are they good in terms of not giving them a bunch of yardage, they keep people out of the end zone. And, of course, you know, it's keep people out of the end zone, you got a really good chance of winning.
How about this? Nearing the two-minute mark, this is just the third total possession in the game. Third and 13 for the Vandals. Just a three-man rush this time. McCoy in trouble still, and the pass is off the hand of Anthony Woods. Fourth down for Idaho, and they'll punt it.
So you're seeing, you know, we talk about quarterbacks getting warmed up, settling in. You're seeing a Saluki defense begin to settle in now. This is the type of defense you watch on tape when you watch these guys. They don't give up a ton of big plays. They tackle well in space, and they make it tough to run for big plays on them as well. So they're settling in right now because they're going to have to show up for four quarters in order to get this road victory.
That drive lasted almost 8 minutes. Idaho started their own one. They didn't even make it past midfield in the end. Chavez to punt again, flagged down. Chavez got knocked down. A flag down at the line of scrimmage.
This is going to be an interesting discussion by the striped shirts.
Prior to the snap, false start, number 19, kicking team. 5-yard penalty, repeat, fourth down.
So, yeah, Chavez got run into, but the penalty came before the snap.
Yeah, it's a dead ball
with the
foul.
Movement.
Yeah, yep, that's exactly right. So, unfortunately, Vandals fans, that didn't happen. What you just saw is like it didn't even happen.
Second team All-Big Sky punter, first team All-Big Sky place kicker, Ricardo Chavez. Angles it in. And Reed comes up with it. He gets mowed down inside the 15. Timeout here late in the first quarter in the FCS second round.
Media timeout.
Since Idaho last hosted a playoff game, it is the 40-year anniversary for Southern Illinois' national championship team, coached by Ray Dempsey. The Salukis blew out Western Carolina 43-7.
Beautiful. Great memories, man. Memories like that, they don't fade. They just get better and better. I know that because I'm an old man, so all my memories are getting better and better.
Southern Illinois starts from the 12-yard line, and Roe Elliott takes it for a couple. Met by Matthias Bertram, the New Mexico transfer. Yeah, Southern Illinois, they've made the playoffs three of the last 4 years under coach Nick Hill, who again played with the Salukis in the mid-aughts. But this team has been in playoff mode really for the last month. They were no guarantee to get in a few weeks ago.
Yeah, they had to win their regular season game and then obviously last week. So like you said, they've been in this mode. This is what they've been dealing with. And so they don't have to figure out how we're going to up our intensity. No, this is it for them. They've been playing playoff mode for weeks.
Elliott again, listed at 5'6". Coaches say, yeah, we fudged it. He's really 5'5". Gains three here, and it's third and five for Nick Hill's team. And the former Saluki quarterback leading Southern Illinois to the playoffs three of the last 4 seasons, including the quarterfinals back in the spring 2021 season.
So you see the subs from the black jerseys. This is their nickel sub package. They can really get after this passer. How do you protect Nick Baker? Because if you keep the pocket clean, he can find the open man.
Just a three-man rush. Baker connects. And Justin Strong has the first down, out to the 24. So Strong, the running back, getting involved in the passing game so far. And that's the final play of the first quarter. That went fast, didn't it?
Yes.
Scoreless in the final second round game of the day in the FCS playoffs. First home playoff game for the Idaho Vandals since 1993. No score. Championship coverage continues next weekend with the quarterfinals across the ESPN networks. For more information, visit NCAA.com, the home for all 90 NCAA championships. We start the second quarter here in the second round of the FCS playoffs. Ted Emmerich, Tyoka Jackson, our entire crew. Idaho, the number four seed, and Southern Illinois, scoreless. The winner of this one will meet the five seed, Albany, next week in the quarters. First down for the Salukis at their own 24. The first quarter featured a total of three possessions.
Got him.
Baker over the top, and the catch is made by Deontay Cox, Baker's teammate, going back to Rochester High School in Illinois, and it's a massive game.
Yeah, slick ball handling here. I think this is a token fake. This is pass all the way. You don't see any of the linemen going too far downfield. RPO look, and you just catching the receiver, Cox, on a seam route with an accurate ball.
30-yard pass play to open up the second quarter. Now it's Strong. And cut down after a solid game. Close to the 40 of Idaho. Tanya McCormick made the tackle, pickup of six.
So this first quarter was all about defense for both teams. And just think about it, they get off to tremendous starts normally. SIU has outscored their opponents by 64 points in first quarters. Idaho by 69 in first quarters. So they're not used to having zeros in this first quarter. Which team now can regroup, make adjustments, and start to put points on the board going forward?
Yeah, they're used to getting off to that fast start.
Yeah.
And putting teams at a disadvantage. Strong again. Met in the hole. Nice momentum from Strong to pick up a couple there. Third and two for the Salukis.
So you mentioned earlier how aggressive these two teams are. This is an opportunity now for a fourth down play. This is just simple outside zone. He cuts it back, defender where he needs to be. So now this is third and two. The play they call will tell us if they're going to go for it on fourth down. If this is a run play or a conservative play, this is going to be a four down play.
Might view this as a two bites at the apple kind of situation.
No question.
They do run it with Roe Elliott. Forget about fourth down. The third down conversion and the touchdown. Roe can go, and the Salukis strike first.
So we talked about him being 5'8", 5'7"-ish. Well, there's some pluses to that, and it's called hiding behind your O-line. Look at the cutback. And once he cuts back, there's nobody there, and he's off to the races. Great job of finding it by Elliott and then exploding through it.
36-yard touchdown run for Elliott, his 10th score of the season. Jake Baumgart nails the extra point. One of the unique features of the Kibbie Dome, no room for the goalpost. The uprights are attached to the walls. Southern Illinois on the board first on the road.
Bro Elliott finds the hole and explodes through it. And he says, welcome, America. You're watching FCS playoffs after dark.
For the goalpost you see everywhere else in America, the uprights attached to the wall. Such a unique look, right?
Very unique. I haven't seen that since my old days at Penn State Haluba Hall. That was our practice indoor facility. Never seen it in a live game action, but guess what? It's all the same. The kicker's got to kick it in between the yellow poles. That's all that matters.
sometimes facing one end zone, they'll kick it at the video board. It'll clang, and you're, oh, did he get the upright? No, it's still good.
Exactly.
There's just no room like you have at other stadiums. So a 7-0 lead for Southern Illinois after the 38-yard touchdown by Roe Elliott. Jackson with a chance to return it. And still on his feet. Corkscrewing ahead to the 30. And to the 35-yard line. Oh, did that ball come out late? A scrum has formed. Southern Illinois says they have it. No signal yet. And still Idaho football. So the Vandals do retain possession. A little scary there. The top four seed trailing first half in the FCS second round.
Yep. So we're back. Take a look at this touchdown one. Look at the guy with the last man on the line of scrimmage, hand on the ground. That's Swinburne, number 83. Watch him start the double team and then climb up. Pause it right there. To go from a 3-yard run to a touchdown run, you need blockers climbing to the second level. That's what springs the back. Great job by Elliott finding it.
And a fumble on the trick play, scooped up by Southern Illinois. And an instant red zone opportunity for the Salukis. Southern Illinois with the takeaway. Peyton Reeves, the big man, scooping it up.
So we talked about this turnover margin being a big part of how the Salukis win. This is now +9, and that's just bad ball handling. Love the big guy scooping, trying to score. That would have been a thick six, and you would have had to hold me down if he scores there, right? I'm just telling you right now. But this is how these guys do it. SIU, they turn you over, and then they score off turnovers.
And so punt, and fumble deep in their own territory to start for the number 4 national seed. Nick Hill's team, golden chance here at the 17. Elliott, who had the touchdown, gets yanked down in the backfield. True freshman Dallas Apalava. Coaches believe he should have been a freshman All-American this year. Loss of 3.
And he got the start. Now look at him get blocked and then get off blocks. That is very unique and rare for freshmen. Freshmen usually don't have the power and strength, Ted, to get off of blocks. He got blocked, got off the block, and made a nice TFL.
The 6th of the year. 2nd and 12. Baker, the 4-year starter at quarterback. 6th-year senior. Underneath and through the hands of Elliott.
Well, he got late pressure and that ball was thrown behind him. You saw the pre-snap motion. That tells Baker it is not man-to-man because nobody moved with him. He understands he's got time. Got some late pressure and it flushed him a little bit. He threw an inaccurate ball. Great opportunity now for this Vandal defense to step up and hold him here and force a longer field goal.
And field goals have been an adventure this year for Southern Illinois, it should be said. Salukis need 12. Baker stepping up. Baker belted. And the pass is caught by Cox. Was he inbounds? There's a flag down in the backfield. Officials confer about the catch. It's incomplete. Cox ruled out of bounds, but let's sort out the penalty at the 25.
So if it's against the Salukis, it's going to be interesting to see if the Vandals decline this call and move them back, or do they take the penalty, take the penalty and move them back, or decline them and force the field goal from here. I don't know if you want to give an extra down to these guys. They're playing hot right now.
Holding, number 68, offense. That penalty declined, 4th down. The ruling on the field was an incomplete pass.
Yeah, just as you said, Ty, make it 4th down. Another look.
Correct, and you said they struggle kicking field goals anyway, so let's see if we can find a hole. Well, and there it is. You're bull rushing a player, and he pulls you down on top of him. That's an old school O-line move. If you're getting bull rushed, try to pull him down and hope the official doesn't catch it. That time, Derek Harden got caught.
The previous play is under further review.
Okay, then. What are they looking at here?
So I'm wondering, are they looking to see if the pass was complete, which would then force the defense to accept the penalty, move them back, and force a fourth down? Well, I think that's smart.
Where Cox caught it, he was still short of the line to gain. It would be about fourth and two, fourth and three, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And Bill McKeever looks into the viewfinder.
I just think this is a smart move by Nick Hill. 1 foot is all you need, Ted. Now, the question is, we can't tell from near, was that toe on the line? That's a great job of concentration by Cox. And he fights for that ball. That's an interception ball that he takes away from the defender.
That's tough to tell from that angle. We're looking at the left foot of Deontay Cox, the seventh-year senior.
Here's another angle, and I don't think this is going to get any better. Well, maybe it will. Let's see. From behind, though, that's going to be tough.
Yeah. View's obstructed.
And so here's the thing. When you're looking at these replays, you got to remember the call on the field is important. They say it was incomplete. Here's our best look right here. And I don't think that's conclusive. So the call on the field says incomplete. You have to have irrefutable visual evidence that the call on the field was incorrect in order to reverse it. I saw nothing that says this is a reversible call.
You're staying up late, you can color in that center square for announcer bingo. Indisputable, irrefutable video evidence. We hear it every game.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah, there you go. But that's the rule. Clear and obvious. Do you have enough to overturn the call on the field? And based on that angle, I don't believe you do.
But again, I think this is a smart decision here by Nick Hill. Force the officials to get involved and see if you can catch lightning in the bottle and say, hey, no, that was complete. And now that forces the hand of the Vandals now to give you an extra play on third down.
What's the call?
After further review, the ruling in the field stands. Fourth down.
So it will be a field goal attempt after the turnover for Nick Hill's team. Jake Baumgart, just 2 of 6 on the year. He missed a 28-yarder last week in the first round against Nichols. This from 37, which would be his season long. And Baumgart drills it. So Southern Illinois comes away with points after the takeaway. And it's a 2-score lead here in Moscow. FCU Kibbie Dome in 30 years, and they're down 10-0 to Southern Illinois out of the Missouri Valley, long regarded as the best league in the FCS, and for good reason, with all the national championships. Of course, North Dakota State with the dynasty, South Dakota State winning the title last year, and the Salukis up 10-0.
Salukis have one of the best kickoff coverage units in all of FCS. This is now 4 weeks in a row on kickoffs. They've seen the ball hit the ground. They're tremendous in this phase. They got a bunch of walk-ons that are fired up.
Yeah, didn't come up with the recovery on the Jackson return last time, and this time it's fair catch for Jermaine Jackson. Well, the 22nd annual Women's Jimmy V Classic is tomorrow, and it's a triple header on ABC and ESPN. First, number one South Carolina and Duke. Then how about this matchup? Rory Harmon and Paige Beckers, Texas and UConn. Then on ESPN 5 Eastern, Ohio State and Tennessee. Boy, the Jimmy V Classic, the women's event, the men's event, always a highlight of the college basketball calendar.
That Paige Beckers, man, I love watching her play.
No doubt.
Her getting hurt last year, that hurt my ability to watch a lot of basketball, because every time she plays, I'm tuning in. Her handle, man, big time range, she's got everything.
Well, Idaho needs jumper cables for their offense.
Love it.
A couple of punts and the fumble. McCoy into the flat. And a short gain for Teron Ivey Jr., the sixth-year senior grad transfer from Coastal Carolina.
Yeah, that's a nice job by Shane Roth. Man coverage. Just keep your eyes on your man and run where he goes. With that misdirection and coming out with the bootleg, they're hoping that Roth would be having bad eye discipline looking somewhere else.
How do you attack this Southern Illinois defense?
Well, listen, I think they have to establish this running game. I mean, just get an opportunity to run the football and then play action. And also, we haven't seen McCoy run the ball more. I want to see him get involved on the edge.
Saw that quarterback draw for 10 yards in the first quarter. Woods, no daylight whatsoever. Peyton Reeves, who scooped the fumble, held him to no gain.
Yeah, so much of what they do is about establishing this run, and this guy was a terrific player. He's got great contact balance, but listen, when you're contacting one of the biggest guys on the field, you can have great balance all you want, but listen, I mean, you just can't get out of Peyton Reeves' hand because he's 6'2", 317 pounds, and he's going against a true freshman up front in the middle of that offense, and so far the true freshman is getting a lesson.
And Ty, once again, a third and long situation for the Vandals. Hayden Hatton has only one catch tonight. He's at the top of your picture. Into the flat, Woods with space this time. Oh, lowers the shoulder, breaks a tackle, but he's still short of the 35. It'll be fourth and a yard. Dune Smith made the stop.
See, I would like McCoy to just kind of hold that football a little bit longer and allow the routes to develop downfield to give then the swing pass more opportunity.
This is a Southern Illinois defense that is one of the best in the FCS, and now they're going to have to defend on fourth and a yard. How about this? Idaho going for it at their own 34. Jack Lane, the redshirt freshman, backup quarterback under center, and a timeout.
Timeout, Southern Illinois. That is their first of the half. 30 seconds.
We're about to see the Vandals tush push, perhaps. We'll see if they stick with it right after this. Join this fight. Remember, every bit of your cash donation goes to cancer research, v.org/donate to help. My mom fought breast cancer for 20 plus years, Ty. I know your family's been affected by it. Fourth and a yard for Idaho. Jack Lane, the redshirt freshman, and movement up front for Idaho. Looked like Charlie Vleem, the right tackle.
My goodness.
Did Southern Illinois jump offsides is the question.
And did they simulate the snap as well? That's an old D-line trick.
Offside, number 93. Player lineup in the neutral zone, causing the offense to react. 5-yard penalty results in a first down.
What a big conversion then for Idaho.
Yeah, what a bad deal for Dante Cleveland, the super senior. You got multiple guys in that neutral zone. So what happens is if you're in the neutral zone, when the offensive player moves, they're going to hit the D-line for being in the neutral zone, saying that they caused it. Dante Cleveland, eighth year, I mean, he should know better. But again, you had multiple defenders jumping in that situation.
Say that again. Eight years in college football.
Yeah, he's going to be drawing his 401k pretty soon. I mean, that's 8 years is crazy.
Man, the Vandals sure needed that, right?
Yeah.
Nothing going offensively. Flag is down in the backfield. McCoy airs it out for Hatton. Did he get the foot down? He did. Inside the 30 of Southern Illinois, but check the marker.
Oh, he's coming back.
Holding, number 71, offense. 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's on Tagana Cisse.
So right now, the Saluki defensive line is winning the battle up front, and they're forcing penalties. And look, I'm going to be honest with you on that one. I'm not buying it. Nice job of getting the toe down by Hatton. But, yeah, if that's holding, Ted, I'm going to be honest with you. I got held almost every play. Yeah. I mean, I don't know how you call that. The defender was losing his balance. He just sort of helped him down. You know I'm not the friends of the offensive line, but that was not holding in my opinion.
So the penalty gave Idaho a first down, but now backed up, first and 20. McCoy just 6 of 9 through the air, 27 yards. Woods sticks his nose in for 3 yards to the 32.
Well, it's been tough sledding for Woods up inside. And it's important that they get him established because they love to run the RPOs and they love to run play action. That's how they get Hatton on these deep digs and comebacks, as you see a Vandal player down.
Yeah, Aiden Kanapik, the sophomore left tackle.
Former walk-on.
Yep. Got put on scholarship before the start of his freshman season. They realized what a gem of a player he was. He was a freshman All-American last season.
6'7", 295, still growing into that frame. He's going to get bigger. He's a terrific prospect. Hoping the This is minor.
It doesn't look like it.
Top left of your screen. He's engaged the second level. Did someone fall on that leg? It looked like that's exactly what happened. I mean, the whole pile fell on it, really. And that, you know, like, I'm not going to speculate, but that yeah. didn't look very good. I like the fact that he's walking out, though. No one's carrying him. There's no cart. He's walking out. That's a very good sign.
And with a little help from head coach Jason Eck.
You're talking about love for your players. I mean, these coaches love their players. You can tell from the conversations we had this week. You can tell how their players play for them. Football is a people business, more than X's and O's. Most people don't realize that. They think it's about scheme and big plays and this and that. This is about people. And you develop friendships and relationships, and none more important between than the head coach and his players. Next man up.
McCoy in trouble, and he goes down at the 22. Dune Smith digging the hole for Giovanni McCoy.
So the domination of the line of scrimmage continues. And now the Salukis are adding people to this rush. What a great job of launching yourself to get over that block. I mean, that's how you do it right there. Dune Smith just refusing to be blocked, and I love how he held on, gathered the quarterback down.
And now it's third and 27 for the Vandals. Abe Christensen has slid over from right guard to left tackle, taking the place of Kanapik. Conservative call, Woods out across the 25 to give Chavez a better chance to punt it.
Tell you right now, this Saluki defense is as advertised. This is the unit I watched on tape. A lot of guys a lot of hats to the ball, but they're very sound. You don't see a lot of busts. You don't see a lot of wide open people running in their secondary. Things that bad defenses do, they make you earn everything, and right now they're making this Idaho offense earn every single yard.
There's a reason they haven't allowed a touchdown in 9.5 quarters. Reed avoids the first man, but gets chopped down at the 30. Well, we mentioned the Women's Jimmy V Classic, the 29th annual Men's Jimmy V Classic, tipping off at Madison Square Garden Tuesday night on ESPN and the app. FAU coming off the Final Four run, matching up with Illinois at 6:30 Eastern, then North Carolina and the defending champs, the UConn Huskies. Of course, to donate to the V Foundation, you can go to v.org.
So if you're the Vandal defense, you got to step up now. Your offense needs you. They need a turnover or a quick three and out to get some field position.
Nick Baker into the flat, and behind his receiver, Isaiah Hartrip, who leads the Salukis in receiving yards this year. Dallas Afalava applied the pressure for Idaho.
Yeah, this young freshman is a good-looking player. I understand why they gave him the start today. He's athletic. 6'2", 255, came free late, and that was just enough to get Baker uncomfortable so he couldn't get the ball to Hartrup.
Now Baker says about Hartrup, he's a guy, I just want to get it to him on the move and let him do his work. And motion, flag down.
Yeah, going to be a false start on the right tackle, Torre.
False start, number 70, offense, 5-yard penalty. Second down.
He knows it. He's slapping his helmet.
That's right. It's always a bad sign. There it is. He was going down block, too. That was most likely going to be some sort of zone running play to Torres or to our right. Most likely. Usually you see that first and 10 incomplete pass. Most offenses are going to come back with a run. After the penalty, though, that changes things.
Baker complete to Vincent Davis III, the transfer from Charleston Southern, out across the 30. A gain of six to set up a more manageable third down.
Well, he's their leading receiver, Vincent Davis. Again, not the most, the fastest guy. He's about quickness for him and creating separation. Another guy that's only 5'8", but he understands how to get open. Just ran a nice hook underneath the zone coverage, made himself available. Ball came out on time and on target. Big opportunity here for this Vandals defense.
They show pressure and flags down again.
It's Torrey again.
False start, number 70, offense. 5-yard penalty, third down.
The junior from Marietta's got to settle down a little bit. Right side of your screen. And just moving early.
I mean, this is what it's like playing in the Kibbie Dome.
That's
it
right.
Can get loud. Yes, capacity 16,000. It's not quite a sellout tonight, but it is rocking.
If this Idaho team can give something for this fans to get excited about, you're going to see the decibels crank up even louder.
Especially if they come up with a stop here. Jalen Benefield gets a block, and Benefield gets dragged down just short of the marker at the 40. Fourth and one, and maybe a decision here for Southern Illinois.
This thing is so well blocked. This is a tunnel screen. Watch the blocking by the top of your screen, the wide receiver. That's a hat on a hat, and there's the tunnel. He got as much as you could possibly get out of that situation, understanding the down and distance, and here you go. Here's the aggression from the Salukis, and a change of mind from the Salukis.
After a little bit of discussion, Nathan Torney and the punt unit do come on.
Yeah, discretion is the better part of valor. I think that's the smart move. I think that'd have been a little too aggressive.
Uh-oh. Oh, check this out. Under center, one of the upbacks. And a handoff goes across the 40 for the first down. Colton Hogue, the junior tight end, racing around the end for the first down.
So two things. It's the patience of Hogue allowing his blockers to get their guys. Watch him come across. Watch the blockers. Now he's finding a one-on-one matchup, and look at the second effort. That play was stopped.
The field is a first down. The previous play is under further review.
She tell you, you can't get them all blocked. And so sometimes it's going to come down to mano a mano. And Omori Amani could not make the tackle at the point of attack.
Well, they're taking a closer look at this. It was Branson Combs, the all-conference linebacker, who went under center and handed it to Hogue. And certainly looked like he picked up the first down with ease.
Armani was right there, though. I mean, you got him. That's the difference between winning and losing in playoff football. Everybody's where they need to be, and there's Armani right there. Make that play. Bring your arms, though. See, he didn't bring his arms, Ted. That's the difference. You can't just go throw your shoulder in, especially against a bigger guy. You've got to make contact, wrap your arms, and run your feet. He stopped his feet, didn't bring his arms, and Quinn kept running.
Yeah, at first glance, you're like, well, what are they looking at here? And you're wondering, oh, did Hogue's knee go down as he lowered the shoulder? That didn't happen.
Yeah. Again, the second effort from Hogue, man. You gotta really be impressed. The fundamentals of tackling. That's one of the things that we go up around the country is doing these games. That's the thing that you see defensively most is lacking. As much as football has changed with the innovation offensively, the tempo, pace, and space, and all of that, when it comes to defensive football, striking, wrapping your arms and running your feet will never go out of style.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. However, after discussion, there was not five players numbered 50 through 79 on the line of scrimmage. Therefore, there will be a foul for illegal formation on the kicking team. It will be a 5-yard penalty and we will repeat fourth down.
Oh my goodness.
My goodness is right. Now here's the question. Did the coaching staff of Idaho, namely Jason Eck, did he understand it and did he notice that? Or was he just Was he just, you know, questioning the spot? I don't think he was questioning the spot because it was obvious he made it, right?
Right.
So you got to give some credit now to Coach Eck and say maybe he saw something fishy and wanted the officials to take a look at it.
And remember, Southern Illinois was thinking about going for it. They substitute at the end. But it, honestly, in that formation, they just didn't have enough offensive linemen.
Yeah, and the call was right. The execution was pretty good in terms of how they ran the football, but didn't execute the formation properly. Man, that's a big play.
And you can see Nick Hill is irate right now, the Southern Illinois head coach. But what a terrific explanation from the referee, Bill McKeever. And now the decision is definitely to punt for the Salukis here late in the half. Jackson off the hop. Jackson weaving through to the 30-yard line. So a nice return for Jermaine Jackson. Maybe that can spark Idaho. The number four national seed needs it. Down 10-0.
McDonald bounces off a tackler. Look at that big boy go. And he still goes to the 25-yard line. Chapman, the split end to the right side for the Vandals. Again, it's McDonald, and he goes inside the five for another Vandal first down. Chapman back in at split end, goes to the right side. Monahan to McDonald, and he's in for the touchdown. He just simply shoved.
A big bully was right. 6'4", 248-pound All-American running back Ray McDonald. Idaho could use him right about now. Here's a screen for Jordan Dwyer out across the 35 and a gain of six. Jason Eck's offense, Ty, right now is stuck in mud.
It's futile. And it's not because they want to be this way. It's the Saluki defense. And they have brought their passion and their hitting into this dome.
Here's Romano charging ahead close to the first down marker and move the chains. Again, this is a Southern Illinois defense coming off a first-round shutout of Nichols. They have not allowed a touchdown in the last nine-plus quarters. McCoy to the flat, and Romano on the receiving end. So a little bit of rhythm here to start for Idaho on this drive late in the half.
And they're increased their tempo. I think that tempo change is helping them get into a rhythm. And McCoy is getting the ball out of his hand quicker and is looking pretty good right now.
Romano again, another Vandals first down.
Now that's the type of movement up front that this Vandal offense needs. If you can get this type of movement inside and control that nose one-on-one, that's a huge part of this offense. You got that freshman center, Leighton Benning. If he can control that nose one-on-one, it's going to allow these guards to get to the second level, and there'll be room to run up inside.
I mean, you said it early in the week, that matchup, Vining against sixth-year senior Cam Bowdry, that can help decide this game as Romano picks up five more yards. So Idaho sticking with the number two back so far on this drive.
And that time they went with a little bit of zone blocking instead of that power man-to-man. And I'm seeing Romano starting to heat up now. Fresh legs. And now they bring Woods back in the football game.
On second and five, McCoy dancing. And McCoy tosses it away.
Smart.
McCoy has had to retreat so often in this first half against that pass rush.
Yeah, these Salukis can really get after the passer. They got multiple guys. They've got 17 different players with sacks. So it's not one guy with a ton of sacks or two guys. They scheme up a lot of pressure, and they jump from three-man front to four-man front. A lot of different guys can get after the quarterback, a lot of athletic players, tweener types.
The Idaho coaches told us it's like facing two different defenses. We don't really know what they're going to throw at us.
I think this is four down territory here, partner.
Third and five. Draw for McCoy. And McCoy is wrangled at the 40 by Dante Cleveland. So do you go for it here at the 39?
Well, you wanted to get a little bit more on third down, I'm sure. But I think this is an opportunity to go for it. You need to find a way to create some points and momentum going into this locker room at halftime, and that's another big-time play by Cleveland, though. Dante Cleveland stepped up because there was some room to run if he could have broke 93's tackle.
Southern Illinois will get the ball to start the second half.
What do you do for protection, Teddy? If you're going to pass this football, do you get your quarterback on the move, or do you add a guy to protection?
You let McCoy use his wheels, I think. Play clock running down. Four-man rush. McCoy lasers it. It's caught. Was he in bounds? Yes. First down for Idaho and Jermaine Jackson.
That's a big-time throw right there from Javonte McCoy. He set his feet, and the ball comes out. You can't rush that fast. You see the little shoulder shimmy? And, boy, that was very close on those sidelines.
Now Romano foraging for 3 yards on first down. Under 2 minutes to play here in the first half. Idaho's engine has been sputtering offensively throughout. Winner of this one will play Albany in the quarterfinals.
But I think it's the offensive line is starting to get this team settled down.
It's the best drive of the night by far. McCoy's the sidestep, and he is lassoed down by Cleveland. The eighth-year senior. Yes, eighth, putting his fingerprints on this game.
The old man is having himself a first half. And you can't hold the ball this long against this pass rush. See, this ball's going to come out, or you got to go. You had room to run up inside. You can't just stand in this pocket. If you stand in this pocket against this defense, I promise you it will collapse on top of you. They got too many guys that can rush the passer.
Tim Varga, their 97 in the white, was slow to get up. Hopefully he's okay. Cleveland, we talked with Antonio James, the defensive coordinator for the Salukis. He says, Dante Cleveland's a grown man. He runs our locker room.
Yeah, he's got 2 degrees. I mean, he said he could be a GA right now if he wanted to be. I mean, he's just been around forever. He's a leader. There's nothing he hasn't seen. And that was Varga who got there first, and then Cleveland played Mr. Cleanup. Got to be smart with this football if you're McCoy.
Worst serve,
you want to get at least 3 points. Excuse me, Ted.
We're just on the edge of Chavez's range here from the 30. McCoy, oh, the little juke. And inside the 25. So that will help out Chavez here on fourth down as we approach a half minute, 10-yard run.
Those are the legs that you were talking about earlier. I like the decisiveness. If it's not there now, go ahead and use that God-given ability that you have to make people miss and get positive yards. Great decision. Now, I think there's only one decision here. I think you got to kick this field goal. I think they're going to let this clock run down,
yep,
call
the
timeout, and kick it.
Heck is right there with the official, ready to call time.
But you mentioned, though, getting him moving. I wonder where they try to do that a little bit more in design move, design running plays, and get him going that way. Sometimes.
Timeout. Idaho. That is their first of the half. 30 seconds.
Sometimes with a dual threat quarterback like that, you can heat him up by getting him moving, getting him confident, feeling comfortable by running the guy, and then all of a sudden these passes begin to look perfect.
So Ricardo Chavez has a field goal attempt here at the end of the half. As we mentioned, he punts with his left foot, he kicks with his right. You've heard about ambidextrous?
Mm.
How about ambipedal? He has a soccer background. Former goalie says when the ball was on the ground, he was comfortable kicking with his right foot, but on goal kicks where he has the ball in his hands, he would kick with his left for more power.
Yeah, I've seen it all now. Now I've seen it all. I've never seen this before today. It's official. I've seen it all now.
A 40-yard attempt for Chavez to put Idaho on the scoreboard. And with the right foot, perfect. And it's a 10-3 game at the half.
The right foot's the good foot.
Jason X said the first time he heard about it, I couldn't believe it. But you know what? It keeps both legs fresh if he's going to be the kicker and the punter.
And listen, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Let the kid do what he does as long as he's going to change the scoreboard like that.
It will be Saluki's ball to start the second half, but Jason X team desperately needed that. Use some support from the Elf as well. Hey, I know him. 10-3, second round of the FCS playoffs. Southern Illinois out of the Valley, Idaho from Big Sky. And it's a one-score game. Kibbie Dome. Halftime here in the second round of the FCS playoffs. It is Idaho and Southern Illinois looking for that trip to the quarterfinal round to face the Albany Great Danes. Well, NCAA FCS championship coverage continues next weekend with, yes, the quarterfinals across the ESPN networks. For more information, visit NCAA.com, the home for all 90 NCAA championships. Well, today you had 8 second-round matchups in the FCS playoffs. Coming up, we will recap the day, including a heart stopper in Bozeman between Montana State and North Dakota State. Check out the weight room here at Idaho. FBS caliber. Forget FCS. You got a few lifts in, Ty, before the game.
You live in places like that. Look at those arms you got right there.
So this is the last second-round game in the FCS playoffs. Winner will play the 5-seed, the Albany Great Danes, which rolled over Richmond. South Dakota State over Mercer, 41-0 defending champ. Mercer was Reese Davis's super dog on game day. It didn't work out for Reese. Mercer could not stay within 32.5 of the Jackrabbits. So South Dakota State and Villanova, that's the top half of the bracket. Look at the bottom half of the bracket. Again, a lot of the top 8 seeds moving on. The lone exception, the 6-seed Montana State. Of course, Idaho's foe in the Big Sky. This was the game of the day against North Dakota State. Bison winning in overtime, 35-34. So North Dakota State and South Dakota in the quarterfinals. And we welcome you back inside the P1 FCU Kibbie Dome. Tyoka Jackson, I'm Ted Emmerich. What jumps out to you overall here in this second round today?
Oh, it's easy. It's that North Dakota State over Montana State. I don't know what it is. I don't know what's in the water, but those Bison have something on those boys in Bozeman. They do it almost every year.
It was an instant classic in Bozeman today. Montana State, North Dakota State, just a couple of years ago, met for the national championship. This was in the second round. We pick it up with the first play of the second half. Tamarick Williams racing 75 yards for a touchdown. Williams, 162 yards and 2 scores on the day. But Montana State answered right back. Tommy Malott living up to his nickname. Touchdown Tommy, 76 yards for the score.
We had him last year in these playoffs. That guy Malott is a big-time player on FCS level. There's no doubt about that.
Malott accounted for 4 touchdowns, 2 rushing, 2 passing. T.K. Marshall, another ultra-talented Bison running back, 29 yards to the house to tie the game at the end of regulation, 28-all. We go to overtime in Bozeman. North Dakota State had the ball first. Quarterback Cam Miller on the option, powers in for the score. So 35-28 North Dakota State. Bobcats need a touchdown to extend the game. They get it right away. Scott Trey Humphrey, 25 yards. And now Montana State just needs the extra point to send it to a second OT. Casey Kautzman.
Oh,
blocked! And that's how the game ended in Bozeman. And so for the fourth time in 5 years, Montana State eliminated in the playoffs by North Dakota State.
In that way, I mean, in order to block an extra point, like, you need the help of the kicking team. That's insane. I don't know if I've ever seen it in that situation in overtime. Oh, God, the guys in Bozeman, I feel so bad for you. But shout out to the Bison. You know, you guys got it done again.
Yeah, I mean, so many storylines in that game, right? Brent Vegan, former North Dakota State assistant, doing a terrific job as the head coach at Montana State, but just breaks your heart if you're a Bobcats fan today. North Dakota State, though, we know the kind of run they have been on. Remember, they won 9 out of 11 national titles before last year when North Dakota State was hammered by Dakota Marker rival South Dakota State. Jackrabbits defending champions coming into this year. Look at the last 5 champs, and yeah, there's a lot of the Missouri Valley here.
I mean, that this is probably the deepest, or at least the best in the top end of any conference in America. And when it gets snowy outside and getting close to the holidays, this is what happens. The Bison rise to the top. They're the cream. And it doesn't usually matter what year it is. They're going to find a way to make and wreak havoc and make a deep run.
Kind of see it in our game, right? Southern Illinois battle-tested by the Missouri Valley and right there with Idaho with a touchdown lead here at the half. We look at the top 4. national seeds in these FCS playoffs. And Montana, the number two seed, the only other game that was going on by the time we kicked off, 41-12, Montana over Delaware. So the number two seed moving on to the quarterfinals to take on Furman. South Dakota's in the quarterfinals. South Dakota State shut out Mercer. Idaho trying to join them. The number four national seed down by a touchdown at the break here tonight. Well, coming up, more here at the half, and we will take a look at the highlights and stats from this slugfest in the second round. Southern Illinois hoping to book their ticket to the quarterfinals in the FCS playoffs. Here are the important dates coming up. Yes, these teams are hoping to eventually go from here in Moscow to Frisco, Texas, the national championship game, January 7th on ABC. Quarterfinals next week, semifinals 2 weeks from today. Idaho and Southern Illinois with one half to determine the final participant in the FCS quarterfinals. Coming up, highlights and stats from the first half here on ESPN2. Second round of the FCS playoffs, a spot in the quarterfinals at stake. Southern Illinois up 10-3 over the number four seed, the Idaho Vandals. McBaker and company up by a score. Well, tomorrow, get started with Sunday NFL Countdown, 9 a.m. Eastern or 6 Pacific if you're here in Moscow. All the early breaking stories, injury updates, previews of each game right up to kickoff, and also right up to the college football playoff selection show, of course, at 1 Eastern tomorrow. Monday Night Football on Monday, 8 Eastern, ESPN and ABC. Hails from Duval County, Jacksonville, leading the AFC South by 2 games, matching up with the Bengals. Last-ditch effort for Cincinnati without Joe Burrow, down to Jake Browning, the UW product at quarterback. And we welcome you back inside the Kibbie Dome, along with the former Penn State great, 12-year NFL veteran, Tyoka Jackson. I'm Ted Emmerich. You know, the story, really, in this game has to be the Salukis' defense. It is now 10 quarters where Southern Illinois has not allowed a touchdown.
Well, you know, you watch them all year and you say they've been dominant, but can they do it against a playoff-caliber team? The answer is yes. Can they do it on the road? The answer is yes. That's the thing about defense. Defense and running travels with you. So right now, this is the blueprint for the upset they're looking for in the playoffs.
We check out the first half highlights, and a lot to like overall for Nick Hill's team. And what have you thought of Nick Baker so far?
Well, I think he's played well. I mean, he showed a lot of poise, even under pressure. He's finding his checkdowns, but I think a lot of it has to do with their ability to run the football. When you can run the football and establish the line of scrimmage, all these token fakes and all these misdirection things, they work. 6.6 a carry. On the other side of the ball, they have not been able to run the football. And Idaho's inability to run the football has not allowed them to get in the rhythm. You see the trick play, ball on the ground, a near thick six, which I got excited about, but didn't happen. But the point is this, you've got to find a way to manufacture in a running game if you're the Vandals offense, because all of what they do, RPOs and play action, and slowing down that rush will be a big part of the second half.
And Dante Cleveland has certainly made an impact for that Salukis defense. How about this Idaho tie? One of the best offenses in the FCS, held to just 92 yards. You mentioned it, just no consistency in the run game, and that means it's a tough ask for Javonte McCoy to create.
No question. 2.0 a carry in the run game. That's not Vandal football. And also, they haven't been very efficient on first down. To be great on third down, which they usually are, you got to be efficient on first down. It was only 3 yards every first down in the first quarter. It got better in the second quarter because the offensive line began to dominate. That offensive line is going to need to lead this second half comeback for the Vandals.
Here in the P1 FCU Kibbie Dome, where they had only 4 home games in the 11-game regular season. First 3 were on the road this year. So, of course, they're jacked up. First home playoff game in 3 decades. And a sluggish start offensively. Salukis ball to start the third quarter. Logan Prescott sends it away, and it's a touchback. Yeah, meanwhile, for Southern Illinois, it is, and they've got the one touchdown in the game, that Roe Elliott 38-yard burst. You mentioned it, Nick Baker, pretty efficient. Overall, 8 of 12, 90 yards. And they would love to be able to stay on schedule themselves.
No question. This is about the offensive line of both teams. The Saluki offensive line, for the most part, has played really well and been in control of the line of scrimmage. As much as football has changed, we talked about the innovation, really the offensive defensive lines are going to rule the day no matter what.
This game's had an old school feel from the start, really. Elliott dives ahead for a yard.
So much of second half play is about adjustments. What do these teams do to adjust to things they weren't doing well in the first half? What does Idaho do to make this offense one-dimensional? You got to shut this running game down and force Nick Baker to have to throw the ball when you know they got to throw it.
Elliott again with a lane, stepping out of a tackle, and it's a first down across the 35. As a defender, Ty, it's got to be so tough to handle a back who's 5'5".
It really is, because you have a hard time finding him. If you stay stuck on a block, he's going to be gone. He's a little bit of a jitterbug. He's got great cutting ability because of those short legs.
Baker airs it out. Hartrick behind the defense, and he dropped it.
Operation was a success, but the patient died. You did everything right. Off of the play action, the route was stellar. You got the separation you're looking for. There's the play action. The ball comes out on time. You got the separation. Catch the football. That's all you got to do. You did everything right. Finish that thing off. We talked about missing opportunities. The Vandals missed one early opportunity in the first quarter. That was an opportunity in the third quarter missed by the Salukis. Let's see if it hurts them.
Hartrick had the step on Armani Arnold there. Second and 10. Now the quick throw to Hartrick to maybe rebuild his confidence a bit. And no gain on the play. X-Ree Alexander, the true freshman. Idaho coaches say, hey, we're fortunate to have him. This is a power five player in the FCS.
He's a freshman All-American. And when you run those screens, you're banking on loafs from the inside out. But if the defense decides they're going to hustle to the football, they can outrun and out-hit those outside screens, and this freshman has a bright, bright future in Idaho.
Alexander, a former Arizona State commit before Herm Edwards was fired last year. Third and 10 for the Salukis.
One of the few third and longs. Here comes the crowd noise to get involved. Can Idaho muster up a pass rush?
Vandals bring four. Baker rockets it. And Davis adjusts to the underthrown ball. First down inside the 30.
See, here's the thing about Baker. When you rush him and things break down, that's a new play for this guy because he has elusiveness. And he's not looking to run. He's just looking to buy time, extend opportunities for his wide receivers downfield. He sets his feet and throws a dart.
This pass is dropped by Aiden Quinn, broken up by Trey Thomas.
Can't say enough, though, how tough that is to give a quarterback like Baker this much time. Ball underthrown, and you had a defender that got lost. Andrew Marshall just had his back turned, couldn't find the football in time.
Baker told us about Vincent Davis. I could tell he was special from his first practice with us since coming over from Charleston Southern. He is electric. On second and 10, Hartrick on the reverse. And Hartrick is spun down by Marcus Harris, the former Oregon State Beaver in his third year with the Vandals.
I want you to watch Marcus Harris. This is how you shut down top of the screen, number two. Nope, no chance on the block. Come to balance, make the tackle by yourself, but it wasn't by yourself because the defense hustling. But that's how you support on the corner and set the edge. Nice job, Mr. Harris.
Loss of two. Rob Orich, the defensive coordinator, told us, hey, Marcus Harris is the leader of our defense.
The Vandals got to find a way to get off the field here, preferably with a sack to make it a tougher field goal opportunity.
Third and long again. Maybe four down territory here as they run it with Strong. Drop the football, and it's picked up by Idaho. Malachi Williams scoops up the fumble. A much needed takeaway for Jason X's team.
Well, you called it. When you're up inside and there's a lot going on, you better cover that football. But it really doesn't matter if the defender's going to come in and punch it out like that. Trey Thomas attacked the football with a Mayweather-type punch to get that ball out.
Knockout. Thomas knows Southern Illinois well. Transfer from South Dakota. Spent the last 5 years in the Valley. Lost to the Salukis in the playoffs 2 years ago.
And I said Mayweather. That was more like Tank Davis the way he knocked that thing out.
McCoy taking a shot on first down and incomplete. He wanted Hayden Hatton, but Hatton was bracketed by Mark Davis Jr. and Iverson Brown.
He wanted Hayden Hatton on a double move. But Mark Davis Jr., as you said, was not fooled. That's great technique from your cornerback. He said, you're not going to beat me deep by getting me to look in the backfield.
Hatton just one catch for 5 yards so far. All-American from last year and most likely an All-American again this year. Could be a day three NFL draft pick. Anthony Woods, who eclipsed 1,000 yards on the season in the first half, nudges ahead for a couple.
So that's the danger when you try to go for a home run on first down. It leaves you with a second and long run that everybody on the defense knows is coming. The Vandals have to establish the running game, I think, on first down, on early downs, to then set up all this other stuff that they're trying to do. The offensive line needs to start dominating the line of scrimmage because this offense is built on the ability to run the ball, run RPOs, and play action passes.
Vandals finally got the offense in gear at the end of the first half, trying to keep this drive going. They've missed on their last five third down opportunities, and McCoy's pass is incomplete. No flag. He wanted Therese Traynor. DJ Johnson had the assignment.
Well, listen, there's a lot of contact going on. And you hear the boo birds coming out, and I think they're booing as much about the offense as they are about the non-call, because there was a lot going on that call. Let's take a look at it. Remember, you got to keep your hands off the receiver when the ball's in the air. And that's a lot of contact at the top of that round. Wow. I mean, DJ Johnson's a very physical player, but I just think that was a foul. Can't beat up the receivers in this day and age. I mean, you just can't. But that time he did.
Play clock running out here.
Delay a game. Number one, kicking team. 5 yard penalty, fourth down.
So Chavez put Idaho on the board with his right foot at the end of the half, and now to punt it away with his left.
Penalty yards are starting to rack up. That's not good for the Idaho Vandals.
Reed won't touch it. And it takes an Idaho bounce out near the 30-yard line. Timeout in Moscow at the Kibbie Dome, Southern Illinois, up by a touchdown. Idaho, Ted Emmerich, Tyoko Jackson, our entire crew. The second round of the FCS playoffs. The winner of this one will meet the Albany Great Danes next week in the quarterfinals. Southern Illinois time had a promising drive to start this second half, but fumbled by Justin Strong, and Salukis do have it back. And it's Roe Elliott, who is hog-tied by X-Ree Alexander, the freshman All-American, gain of a yard.
So many freshmen playing for these Vandals on both sides of the football. What that tells me is two things. One, you got to make sure you keep these guys because they're really good football players, but if you can keep them, man, you're talking about a bright future for this squad.
The coaches flat out told us, hey, we are lucky that Alexander landed with us. Second and nine for Baker. Across his body, incomplete. Hartrip defended well by Arnold. Third and nine.
I'm just sensing a little bit of a lack of intensity. The execution is not quite what it was in the first half, just a little something there. And if you're the Vandals, you got to take full advantage. I mean, that should have been a catch. That should have been a first down. There's no question about it. Now third and long.
I mean, with all the struggles of the Vandals offense, it has been up to this Idaho defense to keep them in this game.
And they've got another opportunity here. You cannot allow Nick Baker to extend these plays and find open receivers. You got to pressure him, but then get him on the ground.
Baker wires it. Hartrup has it. Trying to turn up field, and he's knocked down at the 40. 2 yards short of the line to gain. Andrew Marshall, the true freshman corner, one of a lot of freshmen who play for Idaho on defense, made the tackle.
Stop route there by Hartrup, and then he's going to get everything he can get. Good job of rallying the football, but it was some missed tackles. They're lucky to get him on the ground and make it fourth down. I think this is the right move in this area of the field. No need to go for it here. Your defense is still playing well. Go ahead and punt the football.
Remember, they tried the fake the first half, didn't have the formation right, and it got wiped out. Torney is on to punt here on fourth and a yard. Jackson with the best return men in the Big Sky with a fair catch just inside the 20. So again, these teams trading punts and blows defensively. Jason Eck, again, longtime offensive coordinator, came from South Dakota State a couple of years ago. He's led Idaho to back-to-back playoff appearances. He'd love a lot more production from his offense. But this game is a grinded out, a classic FCS kind of playoff affair.
And there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, both of these teams are used to playing it that way. I think the Vandals need to settle in and run this football. They've got a quarterback who can run it, and they've got Anthony Woods who can run it. Let's establish that.
Saw Luke Schleissner, Idaho's offensive coordinator, there in the box. Came with Eck from South Dakota State. Woods picks up a couple on first down.
So listen, it's easy for me to say, hey, run the football. But he's looking at that line of scrimmage, and it's not moving. This defensive line of the Salukis are controlling things up front, and there's just aren't a lot of room. But you got to continue to call it. Because if you allow these guys to tee off that we saw in the first quarter and the second quarter, That spells disaster for this entire defense. For the entire offense. So you've got to run the football to slow them down up front.
And listen, Ty, Schleissner and Eck are going to throw a lot at you. We saw the double reverse that, unfortunately for Idaho, the Vandals fumble it away. They love to watch a lot of Kansas City Chiefs tape. Here's McCoy on the move. McCoy with a first down. Now those legs. And McCoy's inside the 40. I think the ankle is just fine after that first round bye.
You think?
Gain of 21.
And so this is what I was talking about. This is the adjustments. I think the quarterback run game has been there for them all day. They just need to commit to it because he's dynamic. So a little read option look. And you bring one of your tight ends around as a lead blocker. That's Jake Cox getting a nice block in the open field. And your quarterback's got wheels.
It's the longest play of the game for Idaho tonight. Hatton, he has two touchdown passes this year, and Romano can't catch up to it. Idaho reaching deep into the bag. This is what they love to do. And Hatton and Romano just could not connect.
It's so effective because they run so many wide receiver screens. You see him step back, fake like he's going to run it, and you're talking about wide open. I think he mistimed his dive. It's easy for me to say to rewatch it, but my goodness, Nick Romano. If that ball was more accurate, though, he'd hit his head on the goalpost, no question about it.
It was there. Now Hatton at the bottom of your picture. Second and 10, and McCoy finds him. Hatton after the catch. Out to the Southern Illinois 40-yard line.
So remember, they've gone to a lot of run after a first down complete pass. I love this call. Just a quick little hitch. And again, these DBs are playing off. But what I also like is Jermaine Jackson going to being a lead blocker for Hatton. to get extra yards and spring him downfield.
And Hayden Hatton just passed 1,000 yards for the second straight year. He's going to be a back-to-back All-American for Idaho.
Look at the cushion he's getting at the top of your screen, though. I mean, those stop routes are there all day.
McCoy looking elsewhere this time. Oh. Pass deflected and intercepted by the converted wide receiver, Branson Combs. Now a linebacker for the Salukis. It's another takeaway for Southern.
So this is your leading tackler, but he's a very athletic player, and this ball should never have been thrown there. He's double covered. But I like how greedy Branson is, stepping up in there, not just happy with the pass breakup. Go ahead and make the interception, and boy, that was a huge play.
Man, what a baller look that is with the hoodie, too, under the
like
uniform.
That, huh?
I mean, there's snow outside. We're playing in a dome. Wow.
Oh,
the sixth career interception for Branson Combs. You see Eck urging on the crowd. Second turnover forced by Southern Illinois tonight. Elliott bursting to the 45.
I said Combs was the leading tackler. Of course, he's their second leading tackler. Jules is their lead tackler. But again, I like the ability to step up and make a play. Just inside zone. And look at the finish, though. When your running back is falling forward, that's a bad sign for your defense. You need to push this guy back and not allow them to fall forward.
Baker, complete. Hartrup with a first down in Idaho territory at the 46.
So why does the Saluki offense look like they're more of a rhythm? It's the first down runs, and the efficiency on the first down allows you to call whatever you want when your offensive line is dominating. Here comes some tempo.
The reverse for Davis, flea flicker, and it's blown up. Baker had no chance. Dylan Lane, the linebacker, snuffs it out.
You want to go triple reverse and all the other cute stuff, well, you better get the guys blocked, and you better hope they don't blitz extra people. Dylan Lane almost had that handoff.
Loss of 11 to bring up second and 21.
But that's the negative play that the Vandals defense need. Let's see if they can pay it off now.
Baker offline. Skipped it into Davis. And it's third and 21.
And that play was going nowhere fast anyway. I mean, he got multiple defenders over there unblocked or beaten blocks with speed. And Trey Thomas was coming inside out to lay the wood.
Oh, Baker in the offense right back to the line here on third and 21. Baker dancing. Baker lets it fly for Hartrup, and it's incomplete. Hartrup had space. Fourth down.
If you don't get Nick Baker down on the field, he can hurt you. Just a little bit off. Love the effort there by Hartrup, though. Just a little bit off. Nice pressure from this Idaho Vandal defensive line. They've got to find a way, though, to get little Nick down because he's extending too many plays, and that's dangerous.
Ty, the plays have been there on both sides. The Hatton pass on the trick play for Idaho. Now Baker on third and long to Hartrup, inches away from touchdowns on both ends. Here's Jackson. And Jackson slipping through.
Oh, he's gone.
Jermaine Jackson beats the punter. Jackson, pedal to the floor. Touchdown, Idaho. 84 yards.
When you don't pick up first downs against this Vandal squad, your problems are starting, just getting started, because you got to kick it to him, and he is him.
All caps, H-I-M. Two-time All-Big Sky kick returner. And for the second straight game, going back to the regular season finale, Jackson returns a punt for a score. And just like that, we're tied in the Kibbie Dome.
Media timeout.
So with the great punters, you don't want to overcook, kick your coverage, especially when you got a dynamic return man like this. He makes four guys miss, and this, folks, is a tie game on a house call. You got to make one or two miss on great punt returns. He made four miss. You break four ankles, you deserve to get a house call, and you better not let the punter catch it. But he's not catching Jermaine Jackson, I promise you.
Also, with Idaho's offense in all kinds of trouble, of course, it's up to the return game. Special teams to tie this game up.
Complimentary football, though. The defense of the Vandals came out of the halftime locker room with a different mindset. And I talked about before, you keep punting the ball to number one, he's going to hurt you.
So a new game with 5:22 remaining in the third. Again, one of the more interesting stories in college football, no matter the subdivision, Ricardo Chavez, place kicker slash punter, kicks with his right foot, punts with his left. He's got the soccer background, goes back to his days as a goalkeeper in the Los Angeles area. Just always felt comfortable. Ball on the ground, kick with the right, ball in his hands, like a punt, a goal kick, kick with the left. Chavez got Idaho on the board at the end of the first half, and his extra point tied it up. Baker sets up the screen for tight end Aiden Quinn. And Quinn stepping out of a tackle. Oh, the tight end can move. Out close to midfield.
So well blocked, Teddy. They got big guys out in space, led by Jay Green, the left tackle. Man, he was able to get his hands on a little guy and move people. And like you said, the tight end can move.
Justin Strong lowering the shoulder into Armani Arnold and picking up 6 yards.
You see how these backs, whether it's Elliott or Strong, they continue to fall forward. And I'm just telling you, that's a bad sign. You do not want backs falling forward. It's extra yards. It's like body punches in boxing. Two or three extra yards, they mount up as the carries continue.
Nice start to this drive after giving up that punt return for a score.
That's right.
Baker, open man, caught. And a first down for Deontay Cox. Baker's friend and teammate going back to high school, pickup of 7.
And that 7 gives you a first down. Why? Because you were so good on first down. That's been the key to this offense, being efficient on first down so that third down comes, if it comes, it's third and short.
This could very well be it for Nick Baker, Ty. He told us he is savoring every single moment as a sixth-year senior, every bus ride, every workout, the jokes in the quarterback room. He knows every game could be his last. Baker, flick of the wrist, and Quinn incomplete. Defended by Trey Thomas.
Nice job of getting pressure on Baker, but again, he continues to find a way to get the ball out. And when your coverage is that good, you don't actually have to knock the ball away. If you're in position, which Trey Thomas was, you force perfection from the throw and catch. And usually, you're not going to get perfection, and that's what happened there.
Yeah, you got to drop it in the bucket there.
Yeah, hard to do under pressure.
Yeah. Baker under center this time, and the pitch to Elliott. And Elliott still on his feet out to the 35. So third down upcoming for the Salukis.
So this is a big defensive play for the Vandals. You've got some momentum. Uncle Mo has swung to your side of the field. It's time now to get this offense off the field. If you're the Salukis, you're in a situation here where this is two down territory, right? If you are picking up positive yards on third down, it would be shocking to me if they wouldn't go for it on fourth down.
6 yards needed. Baker trying to find the escape hatch, and he's tossed down. A flag at the end of the play. Amari Notice brought Baker down, but check the marker.
I think it's going to be a face mask. I think they pulled Baker's face mask on the tackle.
Personal foul. Face mask, number 92, defense. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
You called it, time.
And this is where going against a smaller guy can actually be a disadvantage to the defense. Watch him coming in and try to make a tackle. Usually the face of the quarterback's not there. I mean, usually you're going against guys 6 feet or higher, it's just not going to be there. He goes in for a normal tackle, and that's his face mask. He's not trying to do it on purpose, but, you know, that is a foul.
I like how you put it. When you're trying to defend a quarterback who is on the small side like Baker is, you're trying to make him throw from the bottom of a well.
Yeah, absolutely. And they haven't been able to do that. They've gotten some pressure, but they haven't been able to get all four guys closing at the same time.
Baker shrugs off one defender, still on his feet. And Baker tossed down at the end by Zach Kratzer, the fourth-year sophomore from Spokane. Sack and a loss of a yard.
As soon as I say they haven't been able to do it, that's the type of rush where I'm talking about, where you got all four guys fronting them up, where there are no lanes. Keyshawn James Newby told us during the week, we want to be able to close that pocket together. And that's where you get that throwing out of a well effect, where now that height becomes a disadvantage. But if you give him scramble lanes and throwing lanes, you don't have to be 6 foot eight to throw through a clear throwing lane or run through a throwing lane. Not that there are many 6 feet eight quarterbacks, but you get my point.
Where's Brock Osweiler? Shooting through the hole, Roe Elliott. Nice gain to set up third and short. Arnold trips him up. And it'll be third and three for Southern Illinois. Well, the Southern Illinois coaches joked with us this week, we have to be the shortest team in the country up the middle, from center to quarterback to running back. And again, they told us, Baker's really 5'8", Elliott's really 5'5". That's just how they list him.
Look, I don't care how tall you are, because the measure of your heart is going to determine how great a player you are.
Third and three in the red zone. Baker off his back foot. Oh. Strong has it for the touchdown. What an answer for Southern Illinois. There is a flag down near the line of scrimmage, far side. There's also a flag down close to the goal line.
How about the deception there?
Ineligible receiver downfield, number 79, offense. 5 yard penalty, repeat, third down.
The left tackle, Jake Green, with the penalty, nullifying the touchdown by Strong.
And that's terrible. I mean, that's just a terrible penalty right there, because you know what the play is. You know you have to be patient. You know this is a passing situation. He gets downfield, and he barely got downfield. And you see a lot of times the officials will let that go. They will give him a gray area, and, man, that, I'm just telling you right now, the Saluki sidelines are going to be upset about that one. When they watched that film and saw how short amount of yards he went downfield, a lot of teams don't get that call.
Third and eight. Baker, the option, the pitch to Strong, and Strong powers ahead for the first down. First and goal for the Salukis.
Wow. That's how you clear it. A terrible penalty, you forget about it, execute the next play. That's impressive.
So Strong didn't have the touchdown on the play previous, but the 9 yard run moves the chains as the final sand slipped through the hourglass here in the third quarter. First and goal for Southern Illinois. The shovel to Vincent Davis, and he's down to the five. Harris made the tackle. Second and goal. On the other side, I would believe, unless Baker and company want to go quick here, he wants the snap, won't get it off in time. So that brings us...
That is the end of the third quarter. Media timeout.
That's right, Bill McKeever, to the end of three here in Moscow. New game. Yeah, put the four fingers up in the air. FCS After Dark from the Kibbie Dome. Winner heads to the quarterfinals.
Live Sports.
Well, Nick Hill, the head coach of Southern Illinois, wore that Salukis uniform proudly in the mid-aughts. Started multiple years at quarterback for Southern Illinois. And Jerry Kill, one of the great humans in college football, his mentors, coach at the time. Of course, Jerry now the head coach at New Mexico State, within the Conference USA Championship game. This year, in 2007, Hill and Kill led the Salukis to the FCS semifinals. They're in the second round tonight on the road in Moscow, Idaho, and we start the fourth quarter, second and goal, and plunging ahead, Roe Elliott down to the doorstep. A four-yard gain, Trey Thomas makes the tackle, Ted Emmerich, Tyoka Jackson, our entire crew. Now Hill, the head coach at Southern Illinois, and they're trying to take the lead right back.
Did you see that jump cut by Elliott? My goodness. He's got some explosion, some quickness, and I love the way all of these backs finish off runs.
Third and goal. It's Elliott, untouched for the touchdown. And the Salukis reclaim the lead.
The ability to run the football is like a security blanket for a play caller. And Blake Rowland knows that, all things being equal, I can call running plays with confidence with Elliott and Strong and this offensive line because they're humming.
That was a 12-play, 75-yard drive that lasted 6 minutes. The perfect response after Idaho's punt return for a touchdown that tied the score. Salukis back up a touchdown early in the fourth.
Media timeout.
Yes, here in the second round, Ted Emmerich, Tyoka Jackson, our entire crew. The Valley's already knocked out a pair of Big Sky teams today in the second round. South Dakota over Sacramento State, North Dakota State over Montana State in an overtime thriller. And Idaho would like a little more from their offense. They've gotten plenty from Jackson on special teams.
Well, I'm not kicking it to him. I'm going to tell you that right now. That's what I'm not going to do.
He returned a punt, 84 yards for a score. Back deep to receive this kick from Thomas Burks. It's a fair catch for Jackson here. You are dialed in to first down production here for Idaho as they take over.
Yeah, I mean, they did not do a great job on first down. That's why they weren't able to possess the football long enough in that third quarter. They had four plays and got 2 yards, and one of those four plays was an interception. The score is still fine. One possession game. You got plenty of time. But what you have to do is you have to become better on first down. That's how these guys become the number two team when it comes to time of possession. The first down efficiency has to be there. It has to get better. The efficiency is how you're going to get back into this game.
And flags down as McCoy was calling for Woods to shift.
And that's not a great start. And pre-snap penalties.
Yeah, that jumbled up everything.
Snap infraction, number 50, offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
See if that ball, yeah, there it is right there. Got a little hitch in that, and I'm surprised that the defenders jump. I mean, you want to jump on purpose to make the officials make that call. But again, this is not how you start a first down efficient operation. Now you're behind the sticks before you even run a play.
Finding the true freshman, making his fifth straight start after Elijah Sanchez, the starter, went down with an injury. He's lost for the year for Idaho. McCoy down the seam. It's Hatton. And a huge gain out across the 45. So much for the penalty.
Right. He's so adept at finding the voids. And that is a dart right there from McCoy. Excellent throw over the middle. And that's your security blanket right there. Big, strong, with soft hands.
Now Woods cutting it back. And he picks up three.
Now that's not a TFL, and it's decent yards, but you need more. You need more. And you don't need to get away from this run game again, because it's a one possession game with over 13 minutes to go.
Woods trying to turn the corner, and Tim Varga wouldn't allow it. Third and six upcoming. Well, you called for this number. Here it is. Idaho has been a good team in the fourth quarter. How about the differential for Southern Illinois in the fourth?
And how about the guys in the truck throwing the graphic out? You got to love that. But, yeah, if you're an Idaho fan, you're figuring, okay, this is where we want them. We play our best ball now in the fourth quarter. We can out-hit them and outlast them, come back and win this game at home.
Vandals are 0 for their last seven on third down. McCoy on the draw. And McCoy is tackled 2 yards shy of the marker by Branson Combs, who had the interception earlier in the half.
This is a decision right here. I mean, because you're near midfield. If you don't get this first down, you're setting up this Saluki offense with great field position. But on the other hand, you just need 2 yards. And you're starting to build a little momentum offensively. And it looks like the Vandals are going to go for it. And if you're the Salukis, the number one thing you can't do is jump off sides here.
What will Luke Schleissner and Jason Eck come up with here? Two creative minds offensively. Fourth and two, Idaho going for it. McCoy buying time, and McCoy is wrestled down. He is sacked back at the 49. Dante Cleveland again, the eighth year senior.
How about the day the big fellas have it?
Media timeout.
As I said before, they've got a ton of guys, 17 different players getting sacks. This time, the entire white front comes up and makes a big play for this defense. So we're coming back to this sack now. I want you to take a look at the guys in white, the defensive line. One, two, three, four, five. If I'm not mistaken, there are five offensive linemen. That means one-on-one, folks. All you gotta do is beat your one-on-ones and you're gonna get home. And you see multiple guys winning with effort. It doesn't matter who finally gets the sack, it's the entire group who eats. And they're having a great time on the sidelines.
It was Devin Love, the senior from Woodbury, New Jersey, with the sack that forced the turnover on downs. Salukis have it back, and Elliott stops in the backfield. Loss of a couple. Devin Love is a long way from home. Jersey kid making a big play in the fourth quarter in the FCS playoffs.
Another one of these 300-pounders. They've got inside four of them. And remember, we talked about this inside group for Idaho, led by a true freshman that only weighs 275 pounds. That's tough sledding inside.
Second and 12 for Nick Baker, who owns all the passing records at Southern Illinois. Dumps it to Jalen Benefield, and a nice play on the edge by Bertram. Another loss of 2 yards, third and 14.
So Bertram was the unblocked defender, and that looks great on the board, but you got to make the tackle. How many times have we seen the unblocked man, the free hitter, miss the tackle? That's a great job of making a tackle in space against a good back, and you've got the offense right now where you want them on third and long. The whole key, though, they've been really good at rushing Baker, but they haven't been good at getting him on the ground. Two deep safety look. Let's see if they end up that way.
Three-man rush for Idaho. Baker couldn't get away this time. Off a lava, the true freshman with the sack. Fourth down.
And that's the difference right there, Ted. It's one thing to get a rush, but it's another thing to get the quarterback down, especially a quarterback that can move and extend and buy time. You got to punch the pocket, yes. Get him off his launch point, yes. But get him on the actual ground. Now the play is over, and now you're punting to one of the best return men in America.
Last time Jackson returned the punt, it went 84 yards for a score. The old Torney kick it to him. He does. Jackson breaks one tackle and got drilled. Inside the 20. Nice hit on the play from Dune Smith. Timeout. Yes, playoffs from Moscow. This is the bottom half of the bracket. North Dakota State, the one upset on paper. I don't think anyone would consider any Bison win in the playoffs an upset, but they did beat the 6-seed Montana State in an overtime classic. We're in the top half with our game. Southern Illinois and Idaho, and the winner of this one will meet the Albany Great Danes. If Idaho pulls it out, Albany's coming here to the Kibbie Dome. If it's Southern Illinois, they're on their way to the state capital of New York. Idaho taking over after the punt. McCoy hits Hatton for a first down. And Hatton down at the 40. DJ Johnson made the tackle.
It's so important for quarterbacks to feel the rush and not look at it. And that time we saw Giovanni feel the rush. Watch him feel it. And then climb the pocket and then find the open man. That's how you manipulate the pocket, extend the play. First down, Vandals.
Peyton Hatton, the latest alliterative sounding star receiver to come from the Big Sky. Remember Cooper Kupp a few years ago, Eastern Washington, Super Bowl MVP with the Rams. First down, McCoy. And it's Hatton again. Out of the 45 of the Salukis. 14 yards this time.
He's not a burner, Ted. He creates separation with precision in the routes. He's got enough quickness for a guy his size, over 6 foot tall, but you see how he snatched that ball out of the air? We talked about him having strong hands, but soft hands. Great job of catching that football with his hands extended out. His catch radius is terrific.
He's definitely on the NFL radar. Could very well be a late round pick if he decides to come out. He told us he hasn't decided yet. He's a fifth year junior, has 1 year of eligibility left. McCoy up top. Incomplete. Jackson took that hard hit on the punt return. Couldn't get past P.J. Jules. So we look at the top half of the bracket here in the second round. The top seed, defending champ South Dakota State and Villanova set in one quarterfinal, and the winner of this one will play Albany, led by quarterback Reese Poffenbarger, who accounted for four touchdowns today, and the winner of Richmond, one of the best names in college football.
You gotta like anything with Burger in it, you're gonna get my attention, first of all.
Barger.
I'm always thinking Burger, bro. Come
yes.
on. Let me have that.
It's past midnight your time.
Oh, my goodness.
Past 9:30 near Pacific time. And flag down in the backfield.
Okay, listen. I just saw a big old offensive lineman.
False start, number 55, offense. 5-yard penalty, second down.
Abe Christensen, we talked about him moving from guard to left tackle, but he tried his best Denzel Washington impression. He moved, but tried to act like he was just looking at the quarterback. Just looking, no, that was a false start all day long, and thousands of people saw it. But I like the effort to try to play it off, though. You know, sometimes in a two-point stance, they'll allow the offensive tackle to turn and look at the quarterback. Yeah, but that was a little bit of a false start. Nice job, though.
Is that, remember, the Titans Denzel or Training Day Denzel?
I think that was Glory Denzel.
Okay.
A film I was in.
I did not know that. Second and 15, Romano getting loose. And pushed out by Brown at the 25. That'll have to wait. Big play, 21 yards.
Yeah, absolutely.
This I want to hear more about that later.
We'll get to that. But remember, we talked about this Saluki defense. Very rarely do you see a bust. Well, this time they just decided to bring pressure, and this is the right call against that pressure. Their belief is that we can get to the quarterback before he'll find the open man. That's outstanding, an outstanding job by Giovanni McCoy of standing in the pocket, staring down the barrel, and delivering a catchable pass.
So Idaho moving it well here. Had a couple of turnovers that have ended promising drives. Another pass to Hayden Hatton. Still inbounds, Hatton diving for the pylon, and he is marked out at the one. Brown saves the touchdown, 24 yards, as Hayden Hatton has owned this drive.
Well, this is why you don't want to go man-to-man very often against Hatton. Again, he's not the fastest guy, but he's a tough tackle once he gets his hand on the ball.
First and goal for the Vandals. And Woods, flagged down in the secondary. And Woods is pushed back. There's a flag in the end zone.
I think the Salukis are going to get hit for too many men on the field. You saw a late defender trying to hustle off. I think it was DJ Johnson.
Illegal substitution, 12 men on the field, defense. Half the distance to the goal from the previous spot, first down.
Yeah, DJ Johnson was trying to hustle off late and just couldn't get off. Just half the distance to the goal, so it's not the worst thing that ever happened to the defense, but there's Johnson now. He's hustling, but he's not going to get there. Great contact there by the defense. That looked like it was going to be a touchdown all the way. Defense stepped up and made a big hit. This is a push situation here. Let's see if we get it.
Just inside the one. It's still McCoy at quarterback.
He's in the pistol, Ted.
Maybe Woods downhill. And Woods is tackled right at the line of scrimmage by Love. Flag is down.
So interesting. They talked about challenging Anthony Woods to be a more complete back.
Offside, number 50. Player lined up in the neutral zone. Defense, half the distance to the goal. Repeat, first down.
That's on Jalen Banks.
They talked about again, though, they wanted Woods to step up and be, as you see the offsides, he's clearly lined up offsides. Again, not the worst penalty. It's only going to cost him about 4.5 inches. But you want to be onsides because you never know. That ball could have came out. They talked about Woods becoming a better short yardage player. They talked about him becoming a better pass pro guy. More of a complete back. He's always run the football, but he's doing the other things that running backs need to be big-time players.
McCoy motions out. Woods takes the direct snap. Oh. He bobbled it, and that ruined the play. High snap from Vining, allowing Zach Barola to crush Anthony Woods.
The ruling on the field is that the runner was down. Second down.
They mark him down at the four. It's a loss of three for Idaho.
Well, Woods took a shot. And you're lucky you even got that ball in the first place. That's a big, big loss. Again, you go from being first and goal inside the one to now second and goal from the four. Took a shot, boy.
And that's a drastic change. Had it, the nose of the ball was almost touching the goal line a moment ago. Now McCoy on the keeper. And McCoy spills to the three. It'll be third and goal from the three, under six to play, as Idaho searches for the game-tying score.
So this is where your play callers have to figure out, how am I going to scheme this thing up? I got a defensive line that, for the most part, has been a menace to our offense. How do I use that aggressiveness against them? What do I scheme up to put my athletes in space? Because that's when they're at their best.
The Idaho coaches told us they love studying what Andy Reid and the Chiefs do in the red zone. What can they cook up here on third and goal? Another keeper for McCoy. Bottled up, bouncing it, and down at the one. Fourth and goal at the one for Idaho.
So if you're a Vandal fan, you're wondering, why do they keep running this? It's because it's a light box, folks. They're spreading this defense out, and the pre-snap look is saying they've got the advantage with the amount of blockers against the defenders inside the tackle box. The problem is these defenders are out hustling and out hitting the guys in the gold helmets.
There has been all kinds of gnashing of teeth for this Idaho offense against the Saluki defense tonight. Gotta have it. Fourth and goal at the one. McCoy to throw, and it's batted down, but a flag. Mark Davis Jr. defending Therese Traynor. Will this give Idaho first and goal again? Davis is incredulous.
Long conversation with the officials. Not sure what you could be talking about. We're not talking about a spot of a ball. I mean, either this is a pass interference or it's not.
Pass interference, number 17, defense. At the distance to the goal, automatic, first down.
And Idaho still has life on this drive.
Well, Trainer's another one of their big receivers. And yes, yes, he's definitely a little early. Mark Davis is a little early, trying to go through the back of Trainer. Trainer gets inside of him on the post, wins inside. Good call.
First and goal again. Woods twisting in for the touchdown. There is a flag at the line of scrimmage for side.
Looks to be the area of offsides again, partner. They didn't blow it dead.
Offside, number 50. Player lined up in the neutral zone defense. That penalty declined. Result of the play is a touchdown.
And at long last, the Vandals offense is in the end zone tonight.
All you needed was a yard. And it's been hard to get those yards inside, but look at the second effort. Gets hit in midair, spins off of it, reaches, crawls, finds a way. That, folks, is what it's all about.
Now Chavez for the tie. And we're all square at 17. You know, Southern Illinois allowed that punt return for a score earlier in the half, but for the first time in 11-plus quarters, the Salukis defense gives up a touchdown. Tie game. Here at the Kibbie Dome, Ted Emmerich, Ty Okajackson, our entire crew. Idaho answers, and, well, Ricardo Chavez tied it up with the extra point. I guess if you're operating the end zone camera, you need a helmet.
Hey!
Maybe some pads. Look out!
Stay alive now. Never did you think you'd have to make a move on the ball. Nice
well
job,
done
though.
Getting out of the way.
Yeah, a little quickness. Right, I
yes,
see you.
That close. No, you're good, man. You're all good.
Okay, calm down. Don't break your arm. Pat yourself on the back. Relax.
Depth moves there in the end zone. Prescott kicks it away for Idaho, and Southern Illinois starts from the 25 in a new game with 4:17 left. Oh, look out here. Now Prescott trying to save his teammate from any business after the play. Back to the TD.
Yeah, again, Woods, we talked about, they said, hey, we need to be better on the goal line, and it has to start with you. The second effort, at the end of the day, he's 5'11", 185. So he's not going to be a 240-pound thumper. But what you can't measure with height and weight is the heart of a player and a desire. He wanted that touchdown. The second effort got it for him.
And now the game's on the right arm of Nick Baker, the sixth-year senior, 40th career start, all-time passing leader at Southern Illinois. And the drive starts with a run by Roe Elliott to the 30-yard line, a gain of five.
Love the discipline by Blake Rowland. We know the game is tight. The crowd's into it. No need to panic. Just turn back to this run game. Be efficient on first down, something Idaho has been doing all year. They haven't been able to do it on their side. You've been great at it today. Continue to do that and set yourself up. Stay ahead of the sticks.
All three timeouts in the bag for the Salukis. Baker against a four-man rush. Baker wires it. Too tall for Deontay Cox.
Dangerous. Dangerous throw late down the middle in a double coverage. It's a good thing that ball was a little inaccurate, because I'm not sure if he had thrown that ball with a little better ball placement, it could have been something bad. I mean, I think that ball has to come out earlier, and you got a completion.
Tommy McCormick was close to a pick there. Third and five. Idaho rushes three. Baker eluding. And he completes it to Vincent Davis for the first down. What a play by Baker. He's done that quite a few times tonight. This goes for nine.
We've talked about it all night. Pressuring him is one thing, getting him down is another. And you tell me, does it help if you're 5'8" and you can go underneath the sack? Look at him stay alive and throw an accurate ball. Boy, he is a flat-out winner.
He told us this week he was blown away when Southern Illinois offered him a scholarship. Yeah, he won two state championships in high school, but he really thought he'd have to walk on somewhere. Maybe he wouldn't even play college football. Nobody was interested. On first down, Elliott. Back to the line of scrimmage, give him a yard. Nick. Now, Baker owns all the records here at Southern Illinois. Nick Hill, his head coach, told us that he watched Baker win a state championship his senior year, Rochester High School in Illinois. He led a game-winning drive in the rain, and Hill said, my gut said, I get it, he's only 5'8". I gotta have this guy, and look what he's done.
Yeah, and you asked him about it, he gets the sense that the kid, Nick himself, he doesn't really care. He's like, how do you do it? He said, I just go out and play. It never was a problem for me.
Baker hums it, complete, right near the sticks. And a first down for Cox, his teammate, going back to Rochester High School. Harris had the coverage.
First of all, the protection was there. When your quarterback can have a clean pocket, look at that beautiful pocket to step up and throw the football to. And like you said, he put some sauce on that one.
Now Justin Strong up the gut for 3 yards and into Idaho territory. Under 2 minutes to play in a tie game, the winner heads to the FCS quarterfinals to play the Albany Great Danes.
The Salukis are in no hurry. Everything is going in the right direction for them. They're trying to get in field goal range and kick a field goal to win this game. The Vandals have to step up and make some negative plays.
And field goals have been an issue all year. They might have to move it pretty far for that. Here's Baker on the scramble. And a first down inside the 40-yard line.
Inside of 2 minutes, the clock stops on first downs. You need to get your team up to the line of scrimmage and be ready. But again, Baker, this is a run all the way. Nice job of blocking, allowing him to get into the second wave, protect the football. Good job.
Now under a minute to go. Again, the Salukis have all three timeouts. Baker, downfield, and patted down. He wanted Hartrup, and Armani Arnold said, no way, thumbs down from the Idaho corner.
What a play by the redshirt freshman. I mean, you're talking about bright future again. He does a great job of knocking that ball down with the play side arm. Watch the play side arm coming back that thing away. Here's the best thing about it. See, that left arm did not wrap around. So many defenders wrap around with the off arm and get called. That is a coaching tape on how to play man coverage.
46 seconds remaining. Late in the play clock. Baker, avoids the sack. And Baker ends up with positive yardage. Oh, ball comes out, but it's out of bounds. At the 34-yard line, X-Ray Alexander delivering the hit. It's a gain of 5, clock stopped at 38 seconds.
Doug Flutie, young people, please go Google him because he was a menace to defensive linemen.
The ruling on the field is a backwards fumble out of bounds. The clock will start on the snap.
But again, being 5'8 can be helpful. He's ducking underneath these sacks. I know I sound like a broken record, but he's breaking the records. Get to him, get him on the ground, or he will hurt you.
To feel comfortable, Southern Illinois probably needs to get it close to the 20 for a field goal try.
The Vandals defense is showing pressure. There's a check out of it by the Saluki offense. Will they continue with the blitz, or will they check out of it on defense?
3rd and 5. Here comes the blitz, and Cox with the catch and a first down to the 25. Marshall rides him down. Clock stops momentarily at 33 seconds. It's a gain of 8.
Oh, that's great execution. He ran a scissors switch concept on the outside, which is a man beater. So you saw right there, Baker understood what was coming. It was going to be man coverage because the blitz was coming. He understood. Checked into a play where they ran a scissors concept, and the ball came out quickly That way you avoid the rush.
And with all three timeouts here, seems like the Salukis are playing for the field goal right now. Here's Elliott under 10 seconds, and Elliott down to the 22.
Timeout, Southern Illinois. That is their first on the half.
And here you are.
Immediate timeout left.
The timeout with 5 seconds left. And Jake Baumgart comes out here. He will, after the timeout, the game on his right foot right after this.
Live.
5 seconds to play in regulation. Jake Baumgart still on the sidelines. From here, it would be about a 39-yard field goal. The situation here, will Baker try to position the ball in the middle of the field? Southern Illinois then calls a timeout, perhaps very quickly, to give Baumgart a better angle.
I think he called it because Coach Eck is right next to the official.
That's exactly what Baker does, trying to center it up just a little bit. And now the stage is set for Jake Baumgart, the sophomore who had to win a competition in practice this week.
Timeout, Southern Illinois. That is their second of the half, 30 seconds.
For his own job back, yes, Nick Hill, the head coach, reopened the kicking competition this week between Baumgart and Thomas Burks because Baumgart has struggled so mightily all season. Just 2 of 6 this year, and his season long came in the first half tonight as he nailed one from 36 yards. And this is what it looked like in the first half.
And so look, if you're Baumgart, you got to feel confident because the way they called that entire drive, they were setting up for this moment right here. And if you're the Vandals D-line, you cannot be offsides.
3 seconds to go. 41 yards away.
Prior to the snap, timeout, Idaho. That is their first of the half.
You knew Jason Eck was going to do this.
Full timeout.
A little bit of gamesmanship, why not? No need to take it to the locker room with you, right?
Put Jake Baumgart in the ice bath. At least try to do it. The first playoff game in the FCS here at the P1 FCU Kibbie Dome in 30 years. Idaho, a top 4 national seed.
These two
they
teams
tied the game in the final minutes tie, and now it's all down to a kick.
Yeah, I mean, these two teams have given us a tremendous treat tonight. You hate to see anyone lose because the effort has been there all 4 quarters from both teams. Mistakes have been made, mistakes have been overcome, and it all comes down to this right here.
Baumgart's career long, 47 last year. This would be a season long, 41 yards to top the 36-yarder in the first half. The win is 41 yards away. It was deflected! And overtime is on the way here in Moscow. The Vandals block the kick. And we're on to OT in the second round of the FCS playoffs.
My, oh my, let's see who got it. Oh, there it was.
Looked like X-Ray Alexander, the freshman All-American linebacker.
Did you see him jump through? He jumped through the crease. You got to come down and bound again, and what an athlete this guy X-Ray is. True freshman. He was playing high school football this time last year, folks, and he has the biggest play of the season for this program.
Overtime from Moscow is on the other side. FCS After Dark, we're going later. Vandals fan, because your season is still intact. after Exri Alexander blocked the potential game-winning field goal by Jake Baumgart at the end of regulation. So on to overtime. You know the rules by now. Each team with a possession starting from the 25. You have to go for two after a touchdown starting in the second overtime, and then it just becomes a two-point conversion fest with the third OT, the rule change from a couple years ago. So tied at 17, the final spot in the FCS quarterfinals hanging in the balance here at the P1 FCU Kibbie Dome.
All right, men, congratulations on a great game. The rules of overtime are as following. The first overtime period, both teams will have the ball, and when you score, you may go for 2 points or you may kick and try for point. In the second overtime series, you must go for 2 points after a score. The third overtime and every overtime forward will be a two-point try from the three-yard line. We're going to do a coin toss. The winner of the coin toss will determine who's going to play offense and who's going to play defense and what side. As you can see, the helmet is heads, football is tails, helmet is heads. What is the call?
Heads.
Heads is the call. It is a tail.
We want to play defense. We want the call again.
Idaho has won the toss. They elected to play defense first.
Which is, of course, what you want to do.
South Illinois will play offense on this end zone.
So Jason X team will know what they need when they get the football, the last at bat, so to speak. And Nick Hill's offense will have the ball first. Second overtime game of the day here in the second round of the FCS championship. And once again, it's the Valley versus the Big Sky. North Dakota State knocking off Montana State and Bozeman with a blocked extra point
right
at the end of the first OT.
Special teams, I mean, my goodness, it's an afterthought until it's not an afterthought. And that's why it can't ever be an afterthought for your coaching staff and your players. We've seen a punt return for a touchdown, and we've seen a block kick, and that's why we're in this situation right now. And I promise you, the Salukis did not want to be here.
What did Jason Eck, Idaho's coach, tell us? I think special teams can be our edge. That's the only reason this game is still going.
There you go.
The punt return by Jackson, and the blocked field goal by Alexander. Here we go. First overtime. Baker trying to start with a screen, and Rue Elliott is wrapped up immediately by Marcus Harris, the leader of the Vandals defense. Loss of three.
This is why it's so important to watch film, because these formations become tells for the guys who watch the film. And Marcus Harris understood when they line up that wide in 2x2 bunch formation, here comes the screen. I'm anticipating, not guess, but I'm anticipating. If that ball comes out of the quarterback, I'm coming up and making a play.
Baker retreating, and the pass is deflected. Keyshawn James Newby got a bare paw on third down and 13.
I see a different energy from the guys in the black jerseys, Ted. Getting this game to overtime has sprung something, and this defensive line is humming.
And they have been waiting 30 years for a night like tonight here at the Kibbie Dome. First FCS playoff game here, almost to the day in three decades.
That nickel sub packages on the field. These are the best pass rushers that Idaho has. Let's see if they can block them up.
Baker all alone. Just a three-man rush. Down the seam for Quinn. It's intercepted. The ball magnet, Marcus Harris, with his sixth career interception. And now all the Vandals need is a field goal.
Well, this is probably the worst ball we've seen from Nick Baker all day. He's got a tight end open down the seam, but the ball was thrown behind him. And what a catch by Harris. That is not an easy catch, folks. Great job of digging that out. And now any points at all from the Vandals wins the game.
And could that be the final throw of Nick Baker's stellar career? Defense! Idaho has it at the 25. Any score will do for the Vandals now. And all of a sudden, the Kibbie Dome is quiet. About to get loud right now. Woods tightroping the sideline. He stepped out of bounds at the 9.
The game is not over. The ruling on the field is the runner was down.
Woods thinks he ended the game. He did not. Ruled out at the 9-yard line. There is also a flag down in the backfield. The touchdown does not stand.
Both of these teams need to get their poise back because the game is not over.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct taunting number 8, Idaho. It'll be a 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. First down.
Oh, wow. Teron Ivy, Jr., the tight end. So instead of having the ball at the 9, Idaho's got to back up to where they started the possession.
Well, let's see if he stepped out, first of all.
Oh, that's awfully close. Man.
So you're looking for space in between the foot and the white line, and I see green.
Boy, I do too, Ty.
Ooh, my goodness. And so the crazy thing is,
timeout, Idaho. That is their first and final of overtime. 30 seconds.
Great call to call in the timeout there to force the officials to look at it upstairs, right? So here's the thing. If he's not out of bounds, this game's over. The penalty doesn't matter.
That's right. Because it's a dead ball foul coming after the play.
That's exactly right.
And it's not like Woods is taunting on his way to the end zone to take a score off the board.
Correct. Because it's no longer taunting. He's celebrating a game winner.
Correct.
And from that angle, we can't tell. But I think that first angle with the tremendous zoom in from our camera folks, you're just looking for space between his white shoes and the white line. And I see space. I see green in between. That's a touchdown to me.
Well, Bill McKeever never went.
I can't believe it.
Under the hood, so to speak.
I cannot believe it.
And Idaho has it from the 24 after the 15-yard penalty.
And remember, the replay officials have the ability to stop the game just from looking at the replays.
Woods muscling inside the 20.
And if you're the Vandals, you can't worry about that. You got to go ahead and play the next play. But it's our job to talk about it. And I'm saying to you that the replay officials had the ability before that play was run to say, ho, they don't have to call up there. They can say, oh, wait a minute, we need to take a look at this. I think that play was worth that in this situation.
The situation has not changed here, though, after the penalty. The Vandals just need any score to win it. After Marcus Harris came up with the interception on Southern Illinois' drive. Woods has a first down.
I don't think there's any way you put this ball in the air. And if you're Sanukis, you know that. You can't let them run the football here. That's just a simple outside power. He bounces it outside. There's the pulling tackle from the right side, and he's just trying to take it where he can find it. Ball security being of a premium.
You know, when Idaho took over here after the interception, they were immediately in Chavez's range. He's nailed 53 yarders twice this year. Don't you think the Vandals want to end it with a touchdown if they can? Woods knocked down at the line by Iverson Brown, who lost his helmet and will have to sit out of play.
And he lost it because Woods put a hellacious stiff arm on him. And this could have easily been a face mask by the offense right there. That is a penalty when you grab the defender's face mask. But just, again, a split zone play. So you just gonna see basic run plays here. They're just trying to set up their kicker for the best possible kick. But then also, if you're not in your gap, obviously they'll run it in for a touchdown and end it that way.
Chavez missed a field goal in the final seconds in the first round last year at Southeastern Louisiana that would have forced overtime. He would love an opportunity tonight. Maybe he won't need it. Woods to the corner, and Woods is shoved down inside the 10 by P.J. Jules. Gain of four, third down for Idaho.
See, for me, I'm going to kick this ball on third down. There's Woods bouncing outside. Put two hands on that ball, Woods, though. That's the only thing. I'm fine with you bouncing it and trying to get as much as you can, but I'm not fine with that ball being away from your body. And late, he covered it up. But to me, I'm kicking this ball on third down because if you get a bad snap, you can then throw it out of bounds and you'll have fourth down. They're going to leave it to fourth down here. I think that's a little scary.
Heavy set here with a couple of backs. And McCoy centers it up right at the 10. And all eyes turn to Ricardo Chavez. Last year in the first round, he slipped and missed what would have been a game-tying 39-yard field goal with 6 seconds to go. And Jason X team lost 45-42. He told us about the tears in the locker room that he saw on the faces of his players that day in Hammond, Louisiana.
The Salukis do have a timeout. Will they use it?
Of course they will.
Timeout, Southern Illinois. That is their first and final of the overtime. 30 seconds.
You know, Chavez has more time to think about it, but honestly, he's been thinking about a kick like this for the last year. He says it was the greatest thing to ever happen to him. That slip and miss in the first round of the playoffs a year ago. He says that drove him, that fueled him. And he's waiting for the next opportunity, and here it is.
You gotta love it. You gotta love that attitude, man. When something bad happens to you, it's how you react to it. That's what life is all about, and that's why I love this game so much, because it teaches so many life lessons. And one of these life lessons, if you're the Salukis, is, hey, we watch their defense do it. If it's good for them, then we can do it. Number one thing is don't be all size defensively, and if you're the Vandals, you're saying a clean operation will allow our lights-out kicker to win the game for us.
The win is 27 yards away for Idaho. Chavez drills it. Redemption for Ricardo
offside.
Chavez.
Defense. That penalty did fine. Field goal is good. The game is over.
And the Idaho Vandals march on to the FCS quarterfinals. Playoff atonement for the senior and bipedal kicker and punter, Ricardo Chavez.
He's lights out, and the operation was clean. Snap, hold, kick, beautiful. Ricardo says, I'm him.
Can you imagine what's going through his mind right now as he savors this moment? The direct opposite of what he was feeling this time last year in the first round at Southeastern Louisiana. And we are joined by Idaho head coach Jason Eck. Jason, first of all, congratulations on the win. I mean, a night 30 years in the making. This is how it had to turn out, right?
Hey, just so proud of our players, man. Our defense played their ass off all night. You know, Southern's got a great defense. Coach Hill's got a great team. We got a great kicker, though. We got an All-American kicker. So if anybody was watching, vote for him. But he came up big and hit that one. And JJ really got us going. That punt return changed the whole momentum of the game.
Yeah, Coach, I was going to say, you got an All-American kicker, but you got an All-American punt returner as well. Talk about the juice he gave your team with that return.
Yeah, we were struggling to get some energy. You know, we tried to run the trick play, and we just missed it and stuff. But JJ's a great player. He's a warrior. It's two games in a row now he's returned a punt for a touchdown. So just proud for our players. You know, these Missouri Valley teams are so tough. I coached against Nick Hill a lot. But, you know, very, very proud of this team to be one of the top eight teams in the country. I don't know if I could have imagined that when I took this job 2 years ago.
Jason, with all the struggles offensively for most of the night, and again, you're facing one of the elite defenses in the FCS. How was your team able to persevere tonight?
Well, you know what? It was really simple. Let's get the ball to Hayden Hatton. And that, I think, sparked us when we got the ball to Hayden. They got a great defense, and we didn't get them the ball enough in the first half. We got them the ball more in the second half, and a lot of good things happened.
Coach, I really thought your offensive line stepped up in the second half. They were giving up some pressure early, but when you needed them to be strong, they were there for you.
I'm proud of them. We lost probably our one guy who got all conference honors, Aiden Knapp, and got hurt. So Abe Christensen came in and played tackle. Tagana came off the bench and played guard. So just so proud of those guys. And this was a battle, and that's what playoff football is about, man, battling till late at night. And I thought if we could make it go to the end, these guys might get a little tired. It's kind of late Central Time Zone. So thanks for all those guys who watched us and stayed up late on the East Coast.
It's late in the Pacific Time Zone, Jason. enjoy it. I don't think you'll be sleeping anytime soon.
All right. Thanks a lot, fellas.
Congratulations.
Congratulations to Jason Eck and the Idaho Vandals. Dallas Afalava loves it. Of course he does. True freshman. Yeah, this is what playoff football at the college level is all about. So it is Idaho on to the quarters to take on the 5-seed Albany. That game will be right here in Moscow next week.
And what an atmosphere they have here. They're going to take on a really good Great Dane team, but they don't lose a lot here. They've only lost one game. They're now 6-1 at home. Boy, they're happy to be right back here next week.
Oh, the big hug, Jason Eck, and the kiss for his wife, Kimberly. What a special night here in Moscow. Jason Eck said that tonight was part of his vision when he took over a home playoff game. Idaho wins it 20-17 in overtime, and the Vandals move on to the FCS quarterfinals. We appreciate you joining us. For Tioka Jackson and our entire crew, this is Ted Emmerich saying so long from Moscow. College football final is next.